Hello friends, now today we will be starting with pharmacodynamics. Now what does the word pharmacodynamic means? Pharma means drug, okay? And dynamic means effect produced by the drug, okay? So this is the branch of pharmacology which deals with how the drug produces effect or what is the mechanism of action of a drug, okay? So a basic question arises, how a drug produces effect inside the body. Remember, a drug produces effect inside the body when the drug bind to its particular target. So there are various targets of the drug inside the body. When the drug binds to its target, it produces effect. Okay, so this is how a drug will produce effect. So in pharmacodynamics we will be discussing about three points. First, we will be discussing about the types of drugs. Okay, then we will be discussing about the types of targets. And then we will be discussing about how the effect is produced, how we measure the effect which is produced. Remember, when we discuss about the drug, we will discuss about a term known as ligands. Okay, we will discuss about the terms ligands. And when we will discuss about the how we measure the effect which is produced by a drug, remember, we will learn a term known as dose. We will learn a term known as dose response curve. Okay, dose response curve. So by this curve or by this graph, you can also write graph, we measure the effect of a drug. Okay, so in pharmacodynamics we will discuss about what are the different types of drug, what are the different types of target, and how we measure the effect by dose response curve. So in this section, let's start, what do we mean by the word ligand? Okay, and let's discuss about ligand. Okay, now what do we mean by the word ligand? Ligand is a molecule which has a very high affinity for its target. Okay, ligand is any molecule which has a very high affinity for its target. That means when you give this ligand in the body, this drug or a ligand, when you will give this molecule in the body, this molecule will circulate in the whole body, but it will bind to its particular target. Okay, now these ligands are of two type. These ligands could be endogenous ligands or it could be exogenous, which are given from outside. Okay, now remember, endogenous ligands are various chemicals like hormones, neurotransmitters, etc. They are already present in our body and they bind to their specific target. While exogenous ligand, they are known as drugs. Okay, these are the chemicals which you are giving from outside. So exogenous ligands are known as drugs. Okay, while endogenous ligand, they can be classified into various chemicals like hormones, neurotransmitters, etc. So what is the definition of ligand? Remember, ligand is any molecule which has a very high affinity for its target. That means this ligand will circulate in the whole body and it will bind to its target. Okay, now these ligands are further divided into, remember, let's further divide ligands. Okay, we will write types of ligands. Okay, so we already know that ligand has a high affinity for its target. It has high affinity for its target. But the second question arises, when we give this chemical from outside or it is produced in our body, when it bind to its target, because it will go and bind to its target because it has high affinity. So when it binds to its target, the second question arises, what is the effect produced? What kind of effect they will produce? So on the basis of the kind of effect they will produce, they are further divided into. They are further divided into agonist and antagonist. Okay, so they are further divided into on the basis of effect produced. Now remember, when these ligand, they bind to their target, the effect produced by the target is also known as intrinsic activity. Effect is also known as intrinsic activity of ligand. Okay, so instead of the word effect, we also write a term intrinsic activity. Intrinsic activity. Now, what is the difference between agonist and antagonist? Agonist and antagonist, they both have high affinity for the target. That means they will go and bind to that target, but agonist, you will write, they will produce effect. They will produce effect. While antagonist, they will not produce effect. They will not produce any effect. They will just go and bind to their target. So can we say that agonists, they have intrinsic activity? They have intrinsic activity. Can we say that antagonists will not have no or zero intrinsic activity? Intrinsic activity. So can we say that antagonists, they will just go to their target and they will simply bind to their target and they will not do anything? Can we say that antagonists, they will go and simply block the site? They will just go to the target and they will simply block the site. Hence, antagonists, they are also known as blockers. They are also known as blockers. They are also known as pharmacological antagonists. They are also known as pharmacological antagonists. Okay, so antagonists, they are simply known as blockers. So we will be discussing many examples like beta blockers, alpha blockers, etc. Okay, so can we say that antagonists will not produce any effect? Agonists will produce effect. Now a second question arises, sir, how much effect they will produce? Sir, how much effect they will produce? On this basis, agonists are further divided into three. Okay, agonists are further divided into three. They are full agonist, partial agonist, and lastly, inverse agonist. Inverse agonist. Okay. Now, full agonist, you will write, they will produce maximum effect. Maximum effect. Or you will write maximum intrinsic activity. Okay. Now, if you want to describe an effect, let's describe an effect on the scale of 0 to 1. Let's say plus 1 is the maximum effect. 0 means no effect. 0 means no effect. Plus 1 means maximum effect on the scale of 0 to 1. Okay. Can we say that full agonists, they have plus 1 intrinsic activity? Plus 1 intrinsic activity. Okay, plus 1, 0 to 1, 0 means no effect, plus 1 means maximum effect. Partial agonists, you will write, they will produce sub-maximal effect or partial effect. Sub-maximal effect. And you will write, they will have low intrinsic activity. Low intrinsic activity, and their intrinsic activity lie between 0 to 1. Their intrinsic activity will lie between 0 to 1. So can we write this plus 1? If we give a drug, it produces full effect. This is known as full agonist. Okay, then you will write, if a drug will produce sub-maximal effect, you will write it as partial agonist, 0 to 1. Okay. Now, can you tell me, if we give a drug that will not produce any effect, that drug is not known as inverse agonist, that drug is known as antagonist. Remember. Okay, that drug is known as antagonist. If you remember the definition of antagonist, let's see a word. We have written antagonist, they will have zero intrinsic activity, they will not produce any effect. Hence, the drug which will not produce any effect is known as antagonist, they will just block the site. So what is inverse agonist? Inverse agonist, you will write, they will produce inverse or opposite effect. They will produce inverse or opposite effect. So they will have negative intrinsic activity. Negative intrinsic activity. IA stands for intrinsic activity, that is equal to minus 1. That is equal to minus 1. So can we say, if a drug is producing opposite effect, that drug is an inverse agonist. That drug is an inverse agonist. Okay. Okay. Remember this part. So if you remember this graph, full agonist maximum effect, partial submaximal, no effect, antagonist and inverse agonist, opposite effect. Okay, now you should remember certain points regarding this. First point you must remember, if a word is written only agonist and nothing is specified, whether it is full, partial or inverse, if the word only agonist is written, it means full agonist. So we use the term agonist for full agonist. Remember this point. A term agonist means full agonist. It is used commonly, but it is not a correct thing to do. Second point, let's take an example of this graph. Suppose you are sitting quietly and your normal heart rate is 70. Okay, and the maximum heart rate. Now, what do we mean by the word maximum? Maximum means the effect which can be produced maximally under normal physiological condition. We have to define the word maximum. Maximum means the maximum effect which can be produced in normal physiological condition. Remember, when you run very fast, the maximum heart rate which you can achieve in a normal circumstances without any disease condition is 250. Okay, 250. So can you tell me, if we give a full agonist, the heart rate will become 250. So if we give a drug which can make this heart rate to 250 beats per minute, that drug will be full agonist, because it can also achieve the heart rate of 250, which can be produced under normal physiological condition. Can we say partial agonist will produce heart rate, let's say, less than 250? But how much? Let's come to that. Okay, now third point is antagonist. Now the point is, when you give antagonist to your patient, remember the heart rate will remain 70 only, because antagonist, they will not produce any change, they will not produce any effect, there will be no change in the heart rate. So can we say that partial agonist will produce effect between 250 and 70? Let's say, example, if a drug increases the heart rate to 150 beats per minute, that drug will be partial agonist. Okay, so antagonist, remember, they will not produce any change. And if you give a drug and your heart rate decreases, let's say to 30 beats per minute, it will be inverse agonist. So inverse agonist will decrease the heart rate to 30. Okay, but what is the minimum minus one effect? We don't know about that. Just remember, inverse agonist, they will decrease the effect. Okay, remember that part. Okay, so can we say maximum word means the maximum effect which can be achieved in normal physiological condition? But if I ask you, suppose there is a drug known as dobutamine. So dobutamine acts on beta 1 receptors on heart, and it can increase the heart rate to 250 beats per minute. Can we say that dobutamine is full agonist? It's a full agonist. Okay, second point is, suppose there is a drug norepinephrine also acts on beta 1 receptor, but due to some other reason, the heart rate which is achieved is less than 250. So sometimes we call norepinephrine as partial agonist. Okay, because of reflex bradycardia. Okay, third point, suppose you have given a drug beta blocker, the heart rate remains 70 beats per minute. So it will be a blocker. Okay, it will be a blocker. Now suppose I want to give you one example. There is a drug known as isoprenaline. Sir, isoprenaline takes the heart rate to more than 250 beats per minute. It takes a heart rate to more than 250 beats per minute. Can we say it is more than full agonist? It is producing supra maximal effect. So there is a term known as, the drug which produces more than maximum effect, they are known as super agonist. And an example of superagonist is isoprenaline. Okay, so isoprenaline is a superagonist. It can produce supramaximal effect. Okay, so this is the examples of agonist, antagonist, and various types of agonist and antagonist. So remember, full agonist, partial agonist, inverse agonist. Okay, so this is about the types of ligands. Now, before going further, let's discuss in detail a term known as antagonism. Right now, we have discussed an antagonist. Remember, we have discussed one antagonist. This antagonist or blocker is a type of antagonist, that is pharmacological antagonist. Okay, but apart from this, there are various other types of antagonist also. So let's discuss the various types of antagonism. Now remember, there are various types of antagonism. You'll write first the types of antagonism. The first type of antagonism you will write is chemical antagonism. Second, you will write physical antagonism. Third, you will write is physiological antagonism. And lastly, you will write pharmacological antagonism. And remember, only pharmacological antagonism we have discussed till now, they are also known as blockers. And pharmacological antagonists, they are further divided into two. One is competitive antagonist. Second is non-competitive antagonist. So instead of the term non-competitive antagonist, you can also write competitive blocker or non-competitive blocker. You can also use the term blocker instead of antagonism here. So competitive antagonist, they are also known as competitive blocker, and non-competitive antagonist, they are also known as non-competitive blockers. Okay, let's discuss about these antagonists one by one. Let's discuss about chemical antagonists. So what happens in chemical antagonism? We will write, in chemical antagonism, there is an antagonist. It will go and bind to one agonist. And it will bind with chemical bonds. Okay? And because of this reason, agonist will not able to produce effect. Okay, so this is the definition of antagonist. Antagonist will not allow an agonist to produce their own effect. Okay, so the examples of such kind of chemical antagonists you will write are, chemical antagonism. First is, you will write chelators. Chelators, they bind to heavy metal in their poisoning. When there is a poisoning of heavy metals, chelators, they bind to heavy metals by chemical bond, and they are the examples of chemical antagonism. Okay, so the examples of chemical antagonism you will write is chelators. Example, you can write dimercaprol. I am just giving you an example of one metal chelator, dimercaprol. Okay, so it binds with various metals like lead, iron, etc. Second example you will write, there is a drug known as protamine sulfate. Okay, protamine sulfate is an antidote for high molecular weight heparin. Okay, heparin is a very strongly acidic drug, and when their poisoning occurs, we give a strongly basic drug, protamine sulfate. Okay, third you will write monoclonal antibodies. They also bind to antigens which are present in our body through chemical bond. Okay, and all monoclonal antibody, they will end with the word MAB. So just write one example, infliximab. Infliximab. So it binds to one antigen in our body, that is TNF-alpha. Okay, and it is used in cases of rheumatoid arthritis and inflammatory condition, because TNF-alpha causes inflammation. Okay, and lastly, you can write one drug, Sugammadex. Sugammadex. Sugammadex is a very specific novel drug which we have made. It goes and binds to one molecule known as rocuronium. Rocuronium is a muscle relaxant. It's a skeletal muscle relaxant. To reverse the effect of this skeletal muscle relaxant rocuronium, we give Sugammadex. It's a specific antidote. It goes and binds to rocuronium and prevents rocuronium action. Okay, Sugammadex. Okay. So these are the examples of chemical antagonists you must remember. Okay, these are the examples of chemical antagonists you must remember. Now let's come to the second antagonist, that is physical antagonism. Let's come to physical antagonism. So physical antagonism is just like chemical antagonism, but here the antagonist will bind to agonist. Will bind to agonist through physical bond. Physical bond means they will, the agonist will adsorb or stick to the surface. It will stick to the surface of antagonist. The classical example of physical antagonism is activated charcoal. Activated charcoal. It is given for gastric lavage or sometimes whole bowel irrigation, sometimes bowel irrigation, when a person has eaten high amount of poison. So if a person has eaten high amount of poison, this poison may get absorbed and come into the blood. We give activated charcoal. This activated charcoal, it will come and this poison will stick to the surface and it will inhibit absorption of this poison into the blood. Okay, so if the poison is in stomach, we give gastric lavage with activated charcoal, and if this poison has reached intestine, we do bowel irrigation with activated charcoal. So this is the example of physical antagonism. Now let's come to physiological antagonism. Physiological antagonism. Now make a heading, physiological antagonism. Now remember the word physiology means effect. Physiology means effect. Remember. So here the antagonist, suppose this is an antagonist and this is an agonist. Suppose agonist act on its target. Agonist, remember, act on our body target and produces some effect. It produces an effect. What happens in physiological antagonist? A physiological antagonist will act on different target. It will act on different target and it will produce opposite effect. And this opposite effect, which is produced by physiological antagonist, will counter the effect of agonist. Okay, so remember here the main term is it will act on some different target or receptors and it will produce opposite effect of agonist. It will lead to opposite effect. Let's take a very simple example. Let's take, suppose there is a molecule in our body, histamine. Okay, there's a molecule known as histamine. Histamine act on H1 receptor and it produces bronchoconstriction. Bronchoconstriction, which is also known as asthma. Okay, now there is a molecule in our body, adrenaline. There is a molecule known as adrenaline. Adrenaline act on beta-2 receptors present on bronchus and it produces bronchodilation. It will produce bronchodilation. Can we say the opposite effect is produced? With histamine there was bronchoconstriction, with adrenaline there is bronchodilation, but through different targets or receptors, different receptors. That is why the physiological antagonist of histamine in our body is adrenaline. Adrenaline is the physiological antagonist of histamine in our body. Okay, let's take other examples. Similarly, there are examples of leukotrienes. Suppose leukotrienes like LTC4, LTD4, leukotriene C4 and D4, they act on a receptor known as cis-LT1 receptor. Cis-LT1, LT stands for leukotriene, and they also produces asthma or bronchoconstriction. There is a drug known as salbutamol. Salbutamol acts on beta-2 receptor, and it is used for the treatment of asthma because it produces bronchodilation. It will lead to bronchodilation. So it is just like a similar drug like adrenaline, okay? And it is now considered as a drug of choice for asthma because it produces bronchodilation. Can we say salbutamol and leukotriene drugs are among themselves are physiological antagonists? Similarly, you can write other examples like parathyroid hormone. Parathyroid hormone, through its own receptor, produces hypercalcemia. Similarly, we have an hormone, calcitonin. Calcitonin acts on its own receptor and produces hypocalcemia. So the physiological antagonist of parathyroid hormone in our body is calcitonin. Similarly, you will write, there is a molecule known as thromboxane A2. Thromboxane A2. Okay. And there is a molecule known as PG, prostaglandin I2. Remember, thromboxane A2 causes platelet attachment on blood vessel. PGI2 inhibit platelet attachment through its own receptor. So in our body, the physiological antagonist of thromboxane A2 is PGI2. And lastly, you can write one more example, insulin. Remember, insulin, it produces in our blood hypoglycemia. We all know insulin decreases blood glucose level. It produces hypoglycemia. Now there are hormones like growth hormone, glucagon, glucocorticoid, you can write prolactin, all these hormones, they produce hyperglycemia. Or these hormones, they produce hyperglycemia. They are catabolic hormone. Even growth hormone directly is a catabolic hormone. It produces hyperglycemia. Insulin is an anabolic hormone, produces hypoglycemia. Okay, so these drugs are the physiological antagonist of insulin in our body. Okay, so these are the examples of physiological antagonists. So what was physiological antagonist? In physiological antagonism, an antagonist will produce opposite effect through different target or different receptors. Okay, as compared to agonist. Now the last part we have is pharmacological antagonist. Okay. Now the last part we have is pharmacological antagonism. Now this is important for you. Now pharmacological antagonism, here the antagonist will block the binding of agonist to its target. Okay, so here a antagonist will block the binding of agonist to its target. That is why pharmacological antagonists, they are also known as blockers. Why? Because they block binding of agonist to its target. Okay, and they are further divided into two. They are known as either competitive blocker or competitive antagonist, or they are divided into non-competitive antagonist. Okay, now let's see, what do we mean by pharmacological antagonist and what do we mean by competitive and non-competitive blockers. Okay, blockers and antagonists is the same thing. Okay, let's understand the concept first. Suppose, sir, this is a target. This is a target, and this is an agonist. Normally, this agonist, it comes and bind to its target. And when it comes and bind to its target, agonist will produce effect. Now, what happens in competitive blocker? In cases of competitive blocker, there is a molecule. Suppose this is a molecule, competitive blocker. This competitive blocker will compete with this agonist, and it will also come and bind to the same target. But remember, if competitive blocker will bind to the same target, there will be no effect. So can we say if a competitive blocker will bind, it will not allow agonist to bind, and there will be production of no effect? Okay, so can we say that in case of competitive blocker, the competitive blocker will compete for the same site? In case of competitive blocker, a competitive blocker or antagonism, they will compete for the same site or same target. Okay, and can we say, as they are competing for the same target, don't you think the structure of agonist and antagonist competitive blocker should be same? The structure is same. So they have same site and same structure. But what is the difference? One can produce an effect, one will not produce any effect. Okay. And now my question is, let's understand this concept. Suppose there were 100 10 molecules of agonist. There were 10 molecules of agonist and there were 100 molecules of antagonist. Can you tell me who will win the competition? Can we say competitive antagonist will win the competition and it has more chances to bind now? Okay. Now, suppose you have increased the concentration of agonist to, let's say, 10,000. Can we say now which will have more probability or who will win the competition now? Can we say agonist now can win the competition? And can we say now that we can overcome the effect of competitive blocker? We can overcome the effect of competitive blocker by increasing the dose of agonist. So this property is known as they show surmountable effect. Now what do we mean by surmountable effect? You will write, surmountable effect means we can overcome effect of competitive blocker by increasing the dose of agonist. So this is known as surmountable. That means we can surmount the effect, we can overcome the effect of competitive blocker by increasing the dose of agonist. So remember, same site, same structure, and surmountable effect is seen in competitive blocker. Now let's understand the word. Before going further, remember, you'll write, most of the competitive blockers are reversible blocker. Very few are irreversible blocker. Okay, and you must remember that surmountable effect is seen only in cases of reversible blocker. Because if a competitive blocker will come and permanently bind to its target, if you will over increase the dose of agonist, you cannot overcome the effect. Okay, so surmountable effect is only seen in cases of reversible blocker, and most of the competitive blockers are reversible blocker. So what is expected from you is, what is asked from you is the examples of irreversible blocker. Okay, so irreversible competitive blocker, their effect is non-surmountable. Okay, here the effect is non-surmountable. So examples you can write are 81 receptor blocker. They are also known as ARB, angiotensin 1 receptor blocker. Example you can write, all these drugs, they end with the word sartan. You can write losartan. Okay, second you can also write organophosphates. Organophosphate, they inhibit acetylcholine esterase enzyme where normal acetylcholine binds, and it binds with that enzyme irreversibly, organophosphates. Okay, so these are the certain examples you must remember. Their effect is non-surmountable. So they have non-surmountable effect. Okay, non-surmountable effect. Now let's come to non-competitive blocker. Let's understand the concept of non-competitive blocker. In case of non-competitive blocker, there will be a blocker like this. So can we say, and it will come to some different site. Can we say it will bind to some different site? Different site. Let's call this site as allosteric site. So it binds to some different site. Let's call this site as allosteric site. Can we say the structure of a non-competitive antagonist is also different? It will also have different structure. Okay, it will have a different structure. Now the point is, suppose this non-competitive antagonist has bind to its different site. What happens when it binds to a different site? It modifies the structure of target. It will modify the structure of this target. This target structure will get modified. If this target structure is get modified, can you tell me that will Ignis will able and come to bind to its target? The answer is no, because it modifies target. Modifies target. Hence, then Ignis will not able to bind. My question from you is, if you will keep on increasing the dose of Ignis, will you overcome the effect of a competitive blocker? Can you overcome the effect of a competitive blocker by increasing the dose of Ignis? The answer is no. The effect is non-surmountable. The effect is non-surmountable. Okay. So effect will be non-surmountable. You cannot overcome the effect of competitive Ignis. Cannot overcome the effect of non-competitive antagonist by increasing the dose of Ignis. Okay, and most of the non-competitive antagonists are irreversible blocker. Most of them are irreversible blocker. Very few are reversible blocker. So most of the non-competitive blockers are irreversible. And remember, non-surmountable effect is seen in cases of both, whether it is irreversible blocker or reversible blocker. Okay, so non-surmountable effect is seen in cases of both. So what is expected from you is examples of non-competitive reversible blocker. So this was competitive antagonist, this is non-competitive antagonist. Okay, example, you can write one drug, acetazolamide. Remember, acetazolamide is a reversible non-competitive blocker of one enzyme, carbonic anhydrase enzyme. It is a non-competitive blocker of an enzyme, carbonic anhydrase enzyme. Okay, so this is a very rare scenario. Example is acetazolamide. So competitive are mostly reversible. Irreversible are very rare scenario. We have discussed angiotensin 1 receptor blocker, all of them organophosphate. Just try to remember these examples. Okay, they are expected from you and they are asked from you. Okay, so remember this point. Now we have discussed this surmountable and non-surmountable effect. Let's understand this concept graphically. Okay, let's draw one graph. Suppose this is the dose of an Ignis we are giving. Okay, and you are seeing the effect. There you are seeing an effect. Let's say effect is known as response. So let's draw one graph known as dose response curve. Okay, and suppose you have given an Ignis. When you have given an Ignis, can we say the effect is produced? Ignis, they will produce an effect. Okay, So let's discuss. Suppose this is the maximum effect produced by the maximum effect produced by agonist. Maximum effect produced by the agonist. Let's name this maximum effect as Vmax. Okay, let's name this maximum effect as Vmax. Okay, now let's name this dose as, let's name this dose as dose required as Km. Let's name this dose as Km. Okay, so Vmax means maximum effect, Km means the dose required. Okay, now my question from you is, when you have given a competitive antagonist, what will happen? Can we say when we give a competitive antagonist will not allow an agonist to bind to its target? What will happen? The effect will decrease. It will decrease the effect of agonist. Okay? It has now decreased the effect of agonist. Now let's draw it as graphically. Suppose you have given an agonist. The effect is produced like this. Okay, so it is in the presence of antagonist, because antagonist, they are not allowing the agonist to bind, so there will be decrease in effect. Okay, now what you have done, you have started to increase the dose of agonist. As you have started to increase the dose of agonist, there are two scenarios now. There is one graph which is produced like this. When you have started to increase the dose, one graph is produced like this, and in other graph there will be no change. Okay, there will be change. Can you tell me among this green one and this blue one, which is a competitive blocker and which is a non-competitive blocker? We will write this green one is a competitive blocker. Now let's understand why. Can we say as we are increasing the dose of agonist, we can overcome the effect of agonist? So we can overcome the effect of antagonist by increasing the dose of agonist. Okay, as we have seen here, surmountable effect. We can overcome the effect of competitive blocker by increasing the dose of agonist. So can we say in competitive agonist, antagonist, if we increase the dose of agonist, we can produce same level of effect, Vmax. Okay, we can produce same level of effect, but the dose which is required is high. So can we say that in cases of competitive antagonist, Vmax or maximum effect, it can be achieved. It will remain normal. We can achieve that same level of effect. But what do you think about the dose? Km means dose required. Can we say to produce that high level of effect, the dose which will be required in cases of without antagonist, this was the dose which was required to produce maximum effect. In cases of competitive antagonist, the dose which will be required will be more. Okay, we have to increase the dose. So hence Km will increase. Km of a drug will increase. The dose required is increased. What will happen in non-competitive blocker? Competitive blocker. Now what will happen in non-competitive blocker? Can we say non-competitive blocker, it permanently modifies target? So if you keep on increasing the dose of agonist, there will be no change. Can we say the graph will remain same? The graph will remain same, and if there is no change, this is non-competitive blocker. This is the graph of non-competitive blocker. Okay, can we say in cases of non-competitive blocker, Vmax is permanently reduced? Okay, so can we say that in cases of non-competitive blocker, Vmax is permanently reduced? Okay, and if you will keep on increasing the dose, there will be no change in the effect. So Km will remain normal. okay, Km will remain normal. So remember, in cases of competitive blocker, Vmax remains normal, but in non-competitive, the effect is permanently reduced, it decreases. In Km, to produce that same level of effect, we have to give higher dose, and in non-competitive, you increase or decrease the dose, there will be no effect. Okay, there will be no change in the Km. Okay, now remember this Vmax and Km, just write this point, and Km, they are known as Michaelis-Menten constant. Okay, they are known as Michaelis-Menten constant. Just write this point additionally. Okay, so in competitive blocker, the effect is surmountable. Vmax normal, Km increases. In non-competitive, non-surmountable effect, you cannot produce the effect as compared to the normal level, and there will be no usefulness of changing the dose. Okay, so this is all about agonist and antagonist. Okay, now let's discuss, start with dose response curve. Okay, so in pharmacodynamics, we measure the response of a drug. Pharmacodynamic means effect produced by the drug. Effect produced, dynamic means effect produced, pharma means drug. So how we measure that a drug will produce effect or not? We measure by a curve known as, or a graph known as, dose response curve or dose response graph. Okay, better term is dose response curve. It is also known as DRC in short form. Okay, so what is this graph? Remember, we draw a graph of x-axis and y-axis. Suppose this is an x-axis and this is a y-axis. In x-axis, we write dose of a drug. Okay, dose, or you can write concentration of a drug. And on y-axis, when we give a drug, we measure the response, or you can write effect of a drug. We measure the response or the effect of a drug. So this is a simple graph known as dose response graph, okay, or DRC. Now remember, what is the shape of normal DRC? DRC stands for dose response curve. Remember, when we give any drug to our patient or we measure the effect of a drug, the effect produced by the drug is just like this. Okay, the effect produces like this. Okay, let's draw it again. Okay, this is the graph we generally obtain. This shape is known as normal DRC. The shape is parabola. Parabola shape or parabolic shape. This shape tells us about that if we little bit increase the dose, suddenly the maximum response is produced. Suddenly the maximum response is produced. After that, no maximum, the maximum response or the response becomes saturated. Okay, so this is the shape of our normal DRC for majority of drugs. Okay, now this DRC or dose response curve does not tell us about many things. So sometimes what we will do, we change this dose response curve into log DRC. We apply log value. That means we give or change the dose of a drug in log concentration. Okay, so when we convert it into a log DRC, log dose response curve, when we give the dose of a drug in log concentration, which is also known as log DRC, the shape becomes something like this. The shape will become something like this of a log DRC. Okay, the shape will become something like this. Can we say here also the maximum effect is produced? But to produce maximum effect, when we are giving the concentration in log, don't you think it is giving us better variation? So we can easily measure the variable response of a drug. When we change the concentration of a drug in log, By increasing the concentration, we are seeing that the effect is increasing gradually and gradually. Okay, it is giving us better variation. Now this shape, this green shape was parabola. It was showing sudden increase in the response. When we give the dose in log, remember this shape is sigmoid. This shape is sigmoid. Okay, so the shape of a log DRC is sigmoid. Okay, and remember in pharmacodynamics we rather use this sigmoid one. For our measurement of a response of a drug, we use log dose response curve. Okay, we don't use normal DRC, we rather use log DRC, log dose response curve. Okay, so it's better to write in pharmacodynamic we rather use log DRC. DRC stands for dose response curve. Okay, now this log DRC is further of two types. Okay, what is the shape? We know the shape is sigmoid. Shape is sigmoid. Okay, now it is of two type. The first type of dose response curve, log dose response curve, is known as graded DRC. Graded log DRC. Graded log dose response curve. The second one is known as quantile log DRC. That is quantile log dose response curve. Okay, now graded log dose response curve is made for those kinds of a drug, that drugs which show graded response. The drug which show graded response. Graded response means as we increase the dose gradually, as we increase the dose gradually, they show gradual increase in effect. That means if we increase the dose of a drug, with increasing the dose amount of a drug, it shows more amount of effect. Let's take an example. The example is antihypertensive drug. The example is antihypertensive drug. Okay, suppose you have given an antihypertensive to your patient in 10 milligram, let's say it reduces the blood pressure by 20 millimeter of mercury. Suppose you are giving the dose in 10 milligram, it is reducing, it is producing the effect, there is decrease in 20 millimeter of mercury of blood pressure. Okay, it is reducing. As you are increasing the dose, let's say it is decreasing the BP more, 30 milligram, it is decreasing 50. So there are certain drugs that show increase in effect or graded response by increasing the dose of a drug. Okay, now what happens in quantile DRC? There are certain drugs which show all or none effect. All or none effect. All or none effect means either the drug will produce effect or it will not produce effect. Okay, either it will produce yes or no. Example, let's say there is a drug known as antiemetic. Antiemetic drug, they will either stop vomiting or they will not stop vomiting, because we know that there is no term like half vomiting is suppressed, 25% vomiting is suppressed. There is no term like this. So there are certain drugs which show graded response. Hence we make a graph, graded DRC. In quantile DRC, it is made for those drugs which show all or none effect, like antiemetic, here antihypertensive. Okay, now what is the clinical importance of graded DRC? Okay, remember graded DRC we do in one subject. It is done in one subject or one person. Okay, quantile DRC, it is done on percentage of population. Percentage of population, that how many percentage of population is producing effect. Second point you will write, in normal graded DRC we find efficacy of a drug and potency of a drug. In graded DRC we find efficacy as well as potency of a drug. While in Quantel DRC, we find effective dose of a drug. We also find toxic or lethal dose of a drug. And when we compare each of them, effective dose and toxic dose, by comparing effective and toxic dose, we find out therapeutic index of a drug. We also find therapeutic index of a drug. So in Quantel DRC, we find effective dose, toxic dose and therapeutic index. While in graded DRC, in graded dose response curve, we find out efficacy and potency of a drug. In Quantel DRC, we find effective dose, toxic or lethal dose, and comparing them, we find out therapeutic index. So let's start with the first one, that is graded dose response curve. Let's discuss about first graded dose response curve, then we will discuss about Quantel dose response curve. Okay, so let's make a heading, graded log dose response curve. Okay, so suppose there is one person in which you have given a drug and you are seeing the response of that drug. Okay, in one person you are giving the dose in log. Okay, now suppose you have given a drug and that drug has produced an effect, and this was a drug A, so it's a sigmoid curve. This was a drug A. Okay, now suppose this is the maximum effect produced by the drug. This is the, can we say this is the maximum effect or maximum response which is produced? Let's call this maximum response as Vmax. Let's call it as Vmax. Okay, Vmax. Okay, now suppose there is another drug. There is another drug. Let's call this drug as B. Can we say B has produced this maximum effect? Okay, this is the maximum. So in graded log dose response curve, which we have already discussed, we find out efficacy and potency of a drug. Efficacy and potency of a drug. Now what do we mean by the word efficacy? Efficacy means maximum effect produced by the drug. Okay, okay, regardless of dose. It does not depend upon dose, regardless of dose. So if you see this graph which we have made, A and B, can we say A is producing this much response? A, and B is producing this much response. Okay, so remember, efficacy on a dose response curve, it is denoted by Vmax. It is denoted by Vmax on dose response curve. Now, can you tell me among A and B, which is more efficacious? Which is more efficacious? A can produce more effect or B? The answer is A. So can we say that in dose response curve, A is more efficacious than B? A is more efficacious than B. Okay? So how you have determined efficacy on a dose response curve? Efficacy is determined on the dose response curve on the basis of height. It is determined on the basis of height. Okay, the drug which is having more higher effect will be having more, will be more efficacious. Okay, so A is more efficacious than B. Okay, so remember, what is efficacy? Maximum effect produced by the drug. It is denoted by a symbol Vmax, and A is more effective than B because we are seeing the height of A is more than B. Okay, efficacy. Now let's talk about potency of a drug. Now before going further, remember the definition of potency is dose required. So it depends upon dose. Efficacy does not depend upon dose. Dose required to produce 50% of effect. Okay, dose required to produce 50% of the effect is potency, and on dose response curve it is denoted by a symbol Km. Now remember, Vmax and Km, these symbols are also known as Michaelis Menten constant. Now let's understand this part. Now so potency is the dose required to produce 50% of the effect. Now suppose I have drawn a drug. Let's say this drug is C. This is the drug C, and let's discuss, suppose this is the drug D. Can we say the Vmax of C, A and D are all are equal? So can you tell me the efficacy of C, A and D? Can we say efficacy of C, A and D are equal? They are equally effective drug. So can we say the efficacy of C, A and D are equal on efficacy? Okay, they are equally efficacious. Okay, where the difference will come is potency. Now what is potency? Suppose we have fixed the effect, let's say 50% of the effect. Suppose let's say this is the Vmax and this is the 50% of Vmax. Okay, this is, so we have, what we have done, we have made the effect or efficacy constant. We want to see this is the effect which is produced. Now this is the 50% of Vmax, and we have to now calculate at what dose they will produce this effect. Each of these drugs, at what dose they will produce effect. Can we say that this C, it will produce effect, this much effect at this much of dose? The Km of C is this one. Can we say that Km of A will be this one? Can we say that Km of B will be this one? And can we say that Km of D will be this one? Okay, now just remember, can we say that C requires least dose to produce 50% of the effect? A will require little bit higher dose, B will require more dose, and D will require the highest amount of the dose to produce the effect, that same 50% of the effect. Okay, so you will write the drug which require less dose is more potent. Okay, so the drug which required lesser dose is more potent. Remember that part. Can you tell me among C, A and D, they all were equally effective drug, okay, equally efficacious drug, but what about the dose? Can you tell me the potency of C, A and D? Among them, the most potent, can we say C, it required least dose. So they differ in potency. C is most potent, and among D is least potent. Okay, so the dose required to produce effect is least by C, is least dose is required by C. So they differ in dose. Okay, okay, now just compare. And before that, can we say that potency on a dose response curve is determined on the basis of left-sidedness? It is determined on the basis of left-sidedness. The graph which is most left-sided will be requiring least dose. So efficacy is determined on the basis of height, potency is determined on the basis of left-sidedness. Left-sidedness means least dose. So can we say C graph is most left-sided, most left-sided graph? Okay, then A, then B, then D. Okay, now by seeing this graph, just compare between D and B on the basis of efficacy and potency. Efficacy means maximum response Vmax. Can you tell me among D and B which is more efficacious, which can produce more effect? Can we say D is more efficacious than B? it can produce more effect. But if you talk about potency, potency means dose required to produce 50% of the effect, you are seeing that B will require this much amount of dose, D will require this much amount of dose. So which will require lesser dose? B will require lesser dose. So B required lesser dose, hence B is more potent than D. B is more potent than D. Okay, because potency is determined on the basis of left-sidedness and efficacy is determined on the basis of height. Okay, so potency D is more potent than. Okay, now my question is, if you want to choose a drug, if you want to choose a drug between D and B, which drug would you like to choose in your patient? Would you like to choose a drug on the basis of efficacy or potency? Remember, we always chose the drug on the basis of efficacy. Okay, because even if the drug will not able to produce an effect, we will not prescribe that drug in our patient. So remember one point, the choice of a drug, just right, the choice of a drug is always on the basis of efficacy. Always on the basis of efficacy of a drug. We choose a drug always on the basis of efficacy. So can we say among D and B, which was more efficacious? D was more efficacious, hence we choose the drug D. Okay, we choose the drug D. But we know that the efficacy of C, A and D are equal. The efficacy of C, A and D are equal. But what is the difference? Potency. C requires lesser dose. If the efficacy of a drug is equal, then you can choose on the basis of potency. So can we say in that case C is least potent? So C is the best drug we have because it requires least dose and it is most efficacious. Okay, it is the most efficacious. But if a question will come between efficacy and potency, which is the main determining factor for choosing a drug, remember, efficacy is the main determining factor for a choice of a drug. Okay, so the first factor is efficacy. If efficacy is equal, then you can go to the potency. You will use most potent drug, which will require least dose. So among D and B, you will use D drug because it is more efficacious. Among C, A and D, you will choose a drug C. It will require lesser dose and it will also produce maximum response. Okay, so this is all about graded DRC. Let's come to quantile dose response curve. So in quantile dose response curve, we give the dose of a drug. We give the dose of a drug and we see response because it will produce all or none response. Here all or none response will be produced. So we see the response in percentage of population. Percentage of population. So in how many percentage of population the effect is produced? In how many percentage the effect is not produced? So we suppose we give a drug and this drug is drug A. Okay. So again there will be a sigmoid. Okay, so this is the graph which is obtained. So can we say there will be production of response? Let's call this response as beneficial effect. Remember, beneficial effect is also known as therapeutic effect or therapeutic effect. Okay, so this beneficial or therapeutic effect is produced at different dose. Can we say this was the response which is produced in 50% of population? This is the effect which is produced in 90% of population. Okay, so can we say the dose required will be this one? Let's call this dose as ED50. Let's call this dose as ED50. Let's call this dose as ED90. Okay, so can we say this is the dose which will produce effect in 90% of the population and this is the dose of a drug which will produce effect in 50 and 90% of the population? So first term is ED. ED stands for effective dose. Effective dose is the dose of a drug that will produce therapeutic effect that will produce therapeutic effect in some percentage of population. In some percentage of population. So if it is ED50, it will produce effect in 50% of population. At this dose, the drug will produce effect in 50% of the population. In ED90, the drug will produce effect in 90% of population. Okay, 90%. Now remember, this ED90 is the dose of a drug. It is the dose of a drug which will produce effect in 90% of the population. This ED50 is the actual dose of a drug you will find in market. In market, the dose of a drug which you will find when you go and buy a drug, let's say suppose you find a drug paracetamol 500, that paracetamol 500 will relieve headache. So it will relieve headache in 90% of the population. So then in market you will find the actual dose is ED90, which you will find in market. Okay, now let's move further. So what is effective dose? Dose required to produce therapeutic effect in 50% of population. ED50 means it will produce, the dose will produce effect in 50% of population. Let's move further. Suppose you are increasing the dose of a drug now. You are increasing the dose of a drug in very high dose. Can we say it will also produce toxic effect? So after a certain level, can we say at a certain dose level, it will also produce toxic or lethal effect? It is known as toxic or lethal effect. Let's say it is TD50. So TD stands for, also known as LD50. So TD50 or LD50 stands for toxic dose. Okay? Or lethal dose. So it is similar to effective dose. It is the dose of a drug which will produce harmful effect, or you can write toxic effect, in percentage of population, in some percentage of population. Okay, so can we write TD50 will produce, it is a dose which will produce toxic effect in 50% of population. Okay, so toxic dose means harmful effect, effective dose means therapeutic effect. Now if you see this graph, now can we say any dose which is beyond this one, any dose which will beyond this one will be toxic? Okay, any dose which will be below effective dose, you will write there will be no effect. Okay, and any dose which is between toxic dose and effective dose, it will produce beneficial effect. It will produce beneficial effect. Okay, so this is the area where there will be beneficial effect of a drug, but no toxic effect, and there will be effect also. Now my question is, as a doctor, where you want to produce, where you want to maintain the dose level of your drug? Where do you want to maintain the dose level of any drug? Can we say this is the main beneficial area or beneficial window? This is a very good window for us, that any drug which we are giving in our patient, should its dose should lie between effective dose and toxic dose. Okay, this window is also known as therapeutic window. Okay, this is known as therapeutic window or therapeutic index. Or third point, it is also known as therapeutic margin. Okay, so this area between ED50 and TD50, why ED50 and TD50? Because they are on a straight line. Okay, so this area between effective dose 50 and toxic dose 50 is known as therapeutic window, therapeutic index, or therapeutic margin. So let's make a heading, therapeutic window. Therapeutic window or therapeutic margin. Okay, it is the area between TD50 and ED50, toxic dose and effective dose. Okay, now there is a word known as, there are two terms which you must remember. There is a term known as therapeutic index. Therapeutic index. And there is a term which is sometimes, although they are interchangeably used, but let's differentiate these words. Let's differentiate these words now. Although they are interchangeably used, the second point you will write is therapeutic range. Okay. Now what is therapeutic index? Therapeutic index, it is denoted by TI and it is equal to TD50, which is also known as LD50, toxic dose or lethal dose, divided by ED50. Okay, this is the formula of therapeutic index. And what is therapeutic range? Therapeutic range is equal to ED50 to TD50. Okay, ED50 to TD50. Now let's understand this concept now. Okay, now suppose, sir, there is a drug whose ED50 and TD50 are very near to each other. There is a drug whose ED50 and TD50 are very near to each other. If TD50 and ED50 are very near to each other, can we say this ED50 and TD50 are very near to each other and the value of this therapeutic index will become very low? It will become very small value. Okay, suppose therapeutic index value is very small for those drugs whose toxic dose 50 and effective dose 50 are very near to each other. Okay, and suppose the value of this therapeutic index, TI stands for therapeutic index, becomes small. It becomes less than 2. It becomes less than 2. Can we say this area, this therapeutic area window is very small? This is very small. Can we say if we little bit increase the dose of a drug, it will produce toxic effect? If we little bit increase the dose of a drug, it will produce toxic effect. And if we little bit decrease the dose of a drug, there will be no effect. So these drugs whose ED50 and TD50 are very near to each other, which is denoted by a formula therapeutic index, which is less than 2, these drugs are known as narrow therapeutic index drug. These drugs are known as narrow therapeutic index drug. Okay, so this area was also known as therapeutic index or therapeutic margin. So these drugs are also known as narrow therapeutic index drug, which is the best term which we use, sometimes known as narrow therapeutic margin drug or narrow therapeutic window drug. So these drugs, their ED50 and TD50 are very near to each other. Can we say if we will little bit increase the dose, there will be loss of effect, there will be toxic effect, and if we little bit decrease the dose, there will be loss of effect? Can we say the drugs which are very narrow therapeutic index drug, they have a very narrow safety margin? Because if you little bit increase the dose, it will be toxic, there will produce toxicity. So these drugs, they will have very narrow safety margin. Hence therapeutic index, remember, therapeutic index is a measurement of, therapeutic index is a measure of safety of a drug. It is a measure of safety of a drug. Because if you will little bit increase the dose, the drug will produce toxicity. Okay, the drug will produce toxicity. Okay, so let's take an example. So these drugs are narrow safety margin. So let's take an example. There is a drug known as phenytoin. There is a drug known as phenytoin. The ED50 and TD50 of phenytoin is, let's say ED50 of phenytoin is 10 microgram per deciliter. Okay, TD50 of phenytoin is around, let's say 18 to 20. Let's say for our calculation, 20 microgram per deciliter. Can we say this is 10, this is 20? Okay. So can you tell me its therapeutic index? The therapeutic index will be something about 2. And what is therapeutic range? Therapeutic range will be 10 microgram per deciliter to 20 microgram per deciliter. This is therapeutic range. Therapeutic range I told you was ED50 to TD50. Okay, so it was therapeutic range ED50 10 to 20 microgram per deciliter. This will be the therapeutic range, and therapeutic index will be 10, 20 upon 10. It will come out to be 2. Okay, so the phenytoin therapeutic index will be 2. Therapeutic range will be this. So can you tell me what is the units of therapeutic index? The units are no units because it's a ratio. Okay, it's a ratio. Okay, so by seeing this ratio, if the value of this ratio is less than 2, very small value, can we say that drug will be a narrow therapeutic index drug? Narrow therapeutic index drug. By seeing the value of therapeutic index, we can easily measure the drug will be a safe drug or an unsafe drug. Okay, the drug will be safe drug or an unsafe drug by just seeing the value of therapeutic index or TI. If it is a small value less than 2, the drug will be very, very unsafe drug, because if we will little bit increase the drug, it will suddenly produce toxicity. This area is very small. So can we say that any drug which is a narrow therapeutic index drug, that drug will have a very low safety margin? Low safety margin. That means if we little bit increase the dose, it will produce toxicity. So can we say for any drug, we should maintain the dose of a drug in a strict margin? We should maintain the dose of such kind of a drug in a strict margin. Okay. Now the point is, sir, how we can ensure that this drug is not moving, it is not producing toxic effect? How we can measure, how we can ensure? Remember, any drug which is a narrow therapeutic index drug, we will continuously do monitoring with that drug. We will do continuous monitoring with that drug, and we will ensure that these drugs should not produce toxic effect. So any drug which is a narrow therapeutic index drug requires what? It requires monitoring. So any drug which is a narrow therapeutic index drug requires monitoring. Okay, now how we can do a monitoring? Let's check how we will do monitoring. How to do monitoring? Remember, let's say there are certain drugs. Example, there is a drug monitoring of narrow therapeutic index drug. Okay, NTID stand for narrow therapeutic index drug. Suppose there is a drug insulin. Sir, if you little bit increase the dose of insulin, it produces an harmful effect, hypoglycemia. If you little bit increase the dose of insulin, it produces hypoglycemia. My question is, how will you do monitoring? Remember, you will measure blood glucose level. Measure blood glucose. And you can easily find out that toxic effect. You can easily measure the toxic effect of insulin. Okay? You can easily measure the toxic effect. Okay? You can easily measure the effect of insulin. Similarly, there is a drug, let's say clonidine. Clonidine is an antihypertensive drug. It decreases blood pressure, so it may sometimes cause hypotension. Can you measure hypotension? Yes, you can measure blood pressure. Similarly, there is a drug, anticoagulant drug, warfarin. Warfarin is an anticoagulant drug. You can measure prothrombin time. You can measure prothrombin time with warfarin. Similarly, heparin. With heparin, you can measure APTT test, activated partial thromboplastin time. So you can easily measure their toxic effect. Okay, with these drugs. But sir, there are certain drugs whose toxic effect you cannot measure. Suppose I say you, there is a drug known as lithium. Sir, lithium is an antidepressant drug. It is used in mood disorder. Can you measure the mood of a person? Suppose I am giving an antidepressant drug, lithium or any other drug, can you measure the effect? The answer is no. Can you measure the immunity if I am giving some immunosuppressive drug like tacrolimus, cyclosporin? We cannot measure the toxic effect of certain drugs. So the point is, if you cannot measure the effect of a drug, then what to do? Then measure the concentration of that drug directly in the blood. Measure the concentration of drug in blood. So if you cannot measure the effect of a drug, just measure the concentration of the drug which is present in the blood, whether it is between TD50 and ED50. And when you are measuring the concentration of a drug inside the blood, because you cannot measure the effect, that monitoring is known as therapeutic drug monitoring. That monitoring is known as therapeutic drug monitoring, or in short form you will write TDM. So therapeutic drug monitoring is done for those drugs which are narrow therapeutic drugs, and you cannot measure the toxic effect of a drug. You cannot measure the toxic effect of a drug. Okay, but in cases of insulin, clonidine, warfarin, we can measure the effect of a drug. Hence, we will not do therapeutic drug monitoring. We will not do therapeutic drug monitoring. So therapeutic drug monitoring is done in cases of a narrow therapeutic index drug, but you cannot measure the effect. So let's see the examples of those drugs. So let's see the examples of those drugs where you will do therapeutic drug monitoring. You will write a mnemonic: Dat, Lat, CM. Okay, so just write the examples. The first drug is digoxin. In this case, we will do therapeutic drug monitoring. We will measure the concentration of a drug inside the blood. Second, you will write anti-epileptics like phenytoin. Okay, then you will write aminoglycosides, but only in cases of renal failure, because in renal failure their dose are excreted out through the kidney, out of the body. In case of renal failure, their level becomes beyond toxic dose. Okay, the drug you will write is theophylline. Theophylline is the only anti-asthmatic drug which is unsafe, which requires monitoring. Among all anti-asthmatic drug, only theophylline requires monitoring. Then mood disorder drug lithium. You cannot measure depression, mania, etc. Similarly, you will write A for antiarrhythmics. Then you will write anti-cancer drugs, like many anti-cancer drugs you can write. Then you will write TCA. TCA stands for tricyclic antidepressant. Okay, tricyclic antidepressants. C for you will write calcineurin inhibitors. They are immunosuppressive drug. They decrease the immunity of the body. Calcineurin inhibitors. So just write those names of the drug. Calcineurin inhibitor, you can write cyclosporin, tacrolimus. You cannot measure the immunity, hai na? So do monitoring. And lastly, one anti-cancer drug, but we are giving special importance because this question is commonly asked: methotrexate. It's also an anti-cancer drug. Okay, so just remember these drugs. In these cases, we do therapeutic drug monitoring. Okay, because you cannot measure the effect. So before going further, let's discuss everything about therapeutic drug monitoring. So you already know the examples in which cases we will do therapeutic drug monitoring. You will not do in cases of clonidine, warfarin, heparin and insulin therapeutic drug monitoring, because we are measuring the concentration in therapeutic drug monitoring. Okay, there is no need to measure the concentration. It will be a very costly method. Okay, you can easily measure blood glucose, BP, etc. So let's make a heading: therapeutic drug monitoring. Okay, Now, in which cases we will do, what is the purpose of doing therapeutic drug monitoring? What is the purpose? Okay, so you will do, it is given here, we measure the concentration of drug in blood, whether it is between ED50 and TD50. We have to maintain the concentration between ED50 and TD50. This ED50 and TD50 was known as therapeutic range. So we have to ensure the concentration of a drug should be between therapeutic range. Now, what is the purpose? So the first purpose you will write, it is done for a drug which is narrow therapeutic index drug. Therapeutic drug monitoring is done for the drug which are narrow therapeutic index drug. That means these drugs are very having unsafe drug, or these drugs have a very low safety margin. These drugs, they have very low safety margin. Okay, so the classical example of such kind of a drug we can write is, you can write is a tricyclic antidepressant. Tricyclic antidepressant. Okay, example amitriptyline, nortriptyline, etc. Now we have made one more class of antidepressants. Those are known as SSRI. SSRI are selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor. Selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor. Example, fluvoxetine. Now the point is, sir, these SSRI are also antidepressant, but they are very safe drug. They are very safe drug. They do not have low safety margin. So my question is, among these two antidepressants, in which case you will do therapeutic monitoring? We will do only in cases of tricyclic antidepressants, because they are narrow therapeutic index drug. SSRI, they are very safe drug. If you will take many drugs suddenly, 3-4 dose suddenly, it will not lead to toxicity. So the first prerequisite of doing therapeutic drug monitoring is the drug should be narrow therapeutic index drug. Second point is, the effect can of a drug, the effect of a drug cannot be measured. The effect of a drug cannot be measured. Okay, example we have discussed, depression. Okay, you have seen the word depression. Okay, example. So, but if you can easily measure the effect, if you can easily measure the effect, you will not do. You will not do. Example, we have already written insulin, warfarin. We can easily measure the effect of insulin and warfarin. Okay, so this point we have discussed. Now let's move further. What are the other conditions where we will do therapeutic monitoring, therapeutic drug monitoring? First point is, you will write, in cases of nephrotoxic drug. Okay, in cases of renal failure. Okay, suppose there is already kidney damage. Okay, and in cases of kidney damage, you are giving a drug. You don't want to give higher dose. Hence, in cases of kidney damage, renal failure, when we are giving a nephrotoxic drug, we will measure the concentration. We will keep the concentration of the drug very low. The classical example is aminoglycosides. So aminoglycosides require therapeutic drug monitoring in cases of renal failure. Otherwise, they don't require. Okay, second, you will write to check compliance of a drug, whether the person is taking that drug regularly or not, to check compliance. Example, we very commonly do in cases of phenytoin or anti-epileptic drug. Why? Because if a person stop taking phenytoin or anti-epileptic, the person will go into rebound seizures. Okay, but if you will ask from that patient, that person will not able to tell you that I am taking phenytoin or not. So what we will try to do, we check the concentration of phenytoin in the blood. And if you are seeing the concentration of phenytoin in the blood and you are finding it is very low, you can easily say that person was not compliant. Okay, so compliance, we check whether the person was taking a drug regularly or not. And lastly, it is also done for diagnosis and management of poisoning. Because in cases of poisoning of any drug, the concentration of the drug goes beyond TD50 toxic dose. So we monitor the concentration of a drug in cases of poisoning. Let's say there is a very safe drug, example paracetamol. Paracetamol. When a person has taken, let's say, 50 or 100 tablets of paracetamol, it will produce toxicity. So we measure the concentration of paracetamol and we draw a graph. That graph to do therapeutic drug monitoring in cases of paracetamol is known as Romac, Matthew, Normogram. Romac, Matthew, Normogram. We measure the concentration by plotting a graph, by dose response curve type of a graph. Okay, so we see the dose and we see the response. Response, or you will write liver toxicity. So we make a graph. This is a kind of a therapeutic drug monitoring. Okay, and the last point you will write, TDM is not done in cases of. TDM stands for therapeutic drug monitoring is not done or not indicated in certain scenarios. We have already discussed in case of safe drug, we will not do. Second, we have already discussed if you can easily measure the effect. If you can easily measure the effect of a drug, you will not do monitoring. You will not measure the therapeutic concentration of that drug. So if you can easily measure the effect, then you will not do therapeutic drug monitoring. Let's see further. You will also not do therapeutic drug monitoring in cases of hit and run drugs. You will also not do therapeutic drug monitoring in cases of hit and run drug. Now, what is hit and run drug? Hit and run drug, when a person takes these hit and run drugs inside the blood, remember, these drugs, they get rapidly excreted, rapidly removed out of the body. But some amount of this drug becomes irreversible bound to organ. So what are hit and run drugs? Hit and run drugs are those drugs which get permanently or irreversibly bound to an organ. Because of this reason, they may produce toxicity. But what will happen in the blood? So they are not present in the blood because they are rapidly removed. So can you measure the concentration of such kind of a drug inside the blood? When we are doing therapeutic drug monitoring, we are measuring the concentration of the drug inside the blood. Remember, hit and run drugs, they are not present in the blood. They are permanently attached to the organ. So there is no use of doing monitoring in cases of hit and run drugs. Okay. Similarly, you will write certain prodrugs and the drugs which are active drugs, which forms many active metabolites. And in cases of prodrugs, which forms many active metabolites. Remember, if a drug is given into the blood and it forms many other active metabolites, and these active metabolites are producing toxicity, sir, you cannot measure the concentration of all these metabolites. There are many active metabolites. Whose concentration would you like to measure in therapeutic drug monitoring? You cannot measure the concentration of all metabolites. Okay, we don't have any test for that. Hence, in cases of prodrugs and active drug with active metabolite, we cannot do therapeutic drug monitoring. And also in cases of hit and run drugs, we cannot do therapeutic drug monitoring. So these are the reasons where we will not do therapeutic drug monitoring. Hit and run drugs, prodrugs forming many active metabolites, active drug forming many active metabolites. Okay, so this is all about therapeutic drug monitoring and dose response curve. Okay, thank you very much. Hello friends, now we will be discussing about drug targets. Okay, so we started with pharmacodynamics, and we know the meaning of pharmacodynamic. Pharma means drug and dynamic means effect produced by the drug. Effect produced by the drug. And we have discussed a drug produces effect inside the body when the drug binds to its target. When it binds to a target, the drug produces effect. So let's discuss about the various targets of the drugs. Now the drug, How it produces effect in the body can be classified. These targets of the drugs, they can be classified into two. Either they are classified as protein targets, which are made up of proteins, which are the main targets of the drug, or there could be some non-protein targets. Okay? Or there could be some non-protein targets. Remember, the major four protein targets of the drugs are rice. They are the four main targets of the drug rice. Rice stands for receptors. Then we have ion channels. Third we have is carrier protein. Carrier protein is also known as transport protein, or sometimes known as just transporters. And lastly, enzymes. So these are the major targets of the drug. These four are the major targets of the drug. But there are certain drugs which have certain other targets. They are very minor, very few amount of drugs. They will act on certain non-protein targets. Like examples of those drugs are antacids. Antacids, they generally neutralize hydrochloric acid or HCl, which is present in our stomach. Similarly, chelators. Chelators, they generally bind to heavy metals, which is circulating in our body, etc. So these are very minor targets, and we don't have to go into the details of these non-protein targets. Okay, so we mainly have to focus on protein targets, and among these protein targets, we will be discussing about in great detail receptors. Okay, so let's discuss about these protein targets first. Okay, so let's classify them further. So if we classify receptors, see, receptors are further divided into four types. Receptors are further divided into four types. Okay. So there are four kinds of receptors. And remember, among all these four kinds of receptor, three type of receptors are present on cell, on the surface of cell membrane. And the fourth receptor is present inside the cell. Okay. Fourth receptor is present inside the cell. The three which are present on cell surface, the first one is known as ionotropic receptor. Ionotropic receptor. The second one which is present on the cell surface is known as metabotrophic receptor. Metabotrophic receptor. Okay. Now remember, ionotropic receptor is also known as ligand-gated ion channel. It is also known as ligand-gated ion channel. Metabotrophic receptor are also known as GPCR. Metabotrophic, they are also known as GPCR. GPCR stand for G protein coupled receptors. G protein coupled receptors. The third one we have is enzyme linked receptors. Enzyme linked receptors. Okay, they are also known as protein kinase receptors. Protein kinase receptors. Sometimes they are also known as growth receptors. They are also known as growth receptors. And the last one, these three are present on cell membrane. These 1, 2 and 3, they are present on the surface of cell membrane. Okay. And the fourth one is known as intracellular receptor. Intracellular receptor. They are present inside the cell. Okay, this fourth one is present inside the cell. They are also known as nuclear receptor. Earlier they were known as nuclear receptors, but now we better call them as intracellular. This is a better term. Earlier they were known as nuclear receptor. Okay. Now apart from this, the other types of targets of the drug on the cell are, you'll write as ion channels. Okay. Ion channels. Then you will write carrier and transport protein. Carrier and transport protein. And enzymes. Okay. So in this section, we will be mainly discussing about these ion channels, transport protein, and enzymes. In this section, we will discuss first about ion channel, transport protein, and enzymes. After that, we will be discussing about receptors in great detail, because this is the most important part for you. Most of the questions will be asked from receptor. So first, let's complete ion channel, transport protein, and enzymes. So let's discuss first about ion channels. Okay. Remember, ion channels, they are generally present on cell membrane. Suppose this is an ion channel. Okay. And why they are known as ion channel? Because they get open. And when they get open, the ions which are present outside, they come inside. They cause influx of ion channel. But remember, when they will get open? They will get open when there is voltage change. There is change in voltage or potential difference inside the cell. Okay, they get open when there is voltage change or potential change. So when they will open? When the potential difference or the voltage difference inside the cell becomes different, they simply get open. Now don't get confused them with ligand gated ion channel. Remember, we have written ligand gated ion channel. Ligand gated ion channel is a type of receptor. Okay. How it is different from ligand gated ion channel? In ligand gated ion channel, one ligand from outside will come and it will directly open this channel. While these ion channels which we are discussing are, they are opening due to voltage change. Hence, these channels are also known as voltage gated ion channels. They are known as voltage gated ion channels. Okay? So these voltage gated ion channels, they will open when there is change in voltage or potential difference. They are different from ligand gated ion channel. Ligand gated ion channels are receptors. Here what will happen? When they will open? When one ligand will come, that ligand will directly open this channel. Okay. So the examples of these voltage gated ion channels, the drugs which act on them, you can write certain examples like local anesthetics. Okay, local anesthetics, they open voltage gated sodium channel. Sorry, they close voltage gated sodium channel. Okay, similarly, calcium channel blockers. Calcium channel blockers, they close L type of calcium channel. They close L type of calcium channels. So remember, these are the certain examples of the drugs which act on voltage gated ion channels. Okay. Now these two examples you have to remember: local anesthetics and calcium channel blockers. These are must for you, and they act on voltage gated ion channel. We will be coming to ligand gated ion channel. For your information, you can also write ATP sensitive potassium channel. Just for your information, you can write which are present on beta cells and they release insulin. So there is one drug which act on ATP sensitive potassium channel. These drugs are sulfonylureas. They are used in diabetes. Sulfonylureas. So remember, these are the three examples of voltage gated ion channels. Okay, now let's talk about transport proteins. Let's talk about transport proteins. They are also known as carrier proteins because they are responsible for carrying or transport of certain substances across the cell membrane. Carrier proteins, they are simply known as transporters also. They are simply known as transporters also. Okay. So certain drugs which act on transporter proteins, you can write. Okay, you can write diuretics. The examples of the drugs like diuretics, example thiazide diuretic. Thiazide diuretic, it inhibit sodium chloride symporter, which is present on renal tubules, which is present on renal tubules or kidney. Similarly, you can write loop diuretic. Loop diuretic will inhibit sodium potassium 2 chloride symporter, which is present on renal tubule. So they will act on renal tubular cells. Similarly, there is a drug known as antidepressants. There is a drug known as antidepressants like SSRI, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor. They inhibit one transporter. Suppose this is a neuron, and this neuron is releasing serotonin. Remember, this serotonin is reuptaken. It is reuptaken by the same neuron with a transporter known as SET. SET stands for serotonin transporter. So SSRI, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, they inhibit this transporter present on neurons. Okay, so antidepressant, they inhibit transporters which are present on neurons. Diuretics, they will inhibit transporter present on renal tubule. So example is SSRI, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor. You can write the name of the drug, fluoxetine. Similarly, tricyclic antidepressants. So most of the antidepressants, they act in a similar fashion. Tricyclic antidepressant. So most of the antidepressant, they act in a same fashion. Tricyclic antidepressant, apart from SET, they also inhibit reuptake of norepinephrine. Norepinephrine by inhibiting a transporter NET, norepinephrine transporter. Okay, so these are the two examples which you must remember. Apart from this, if you want to remember certain other examples, you can write proton pump inhibitor. Proton pump inhibitor, they inhibit one transporter. That transporter is hydrogen potassium ATPase. Okay, hydrogen potassium ATPase, which is present in stomach cells. Okay, so when H plus is secreted, it increases gastric pH and hence it increases acidity in stomach. So proton pump inhibitors, they inhibit hydrogen potassium ATPase present on stomach. So all proton pump inhibitor, they end with the word prazole, like omeprazole. Okay, so this is another example of a drug which inhibit a transporter. Okay, so these examples you must remember. Now the last target of a drug was enzymes. Okay, the last targets of the drug was enzymes. Now remember, most of the drugs, they inhibit enzyme. So let's discuss about enzyme inhibition. Now remember, enzymes can be inhibited in two fashion. Either the enzyme is inhibited in a reversible fashion by a drug, or there is irreversible enzyme inhibition. Okay, remember, any drug which binds to its target or enzyme irreversibly, it binds with a bond known as covalent bond. It binds with covalent bond, and these bonds cannot be broken. While in reversible inhibition, they bind with ionic bonds. Okay, now can we say if a drug has bound to an enzyme irreversibly, this enzyme now is permanently dead? That is why irreversible enzyme inhibition is also known as suicide inhibition. It is also known as suicide inhibition. Okay, now remember, this examples of certain reversible and irreversible enzyme inhibition, you can write examples like reversible statins. Statins are the drugs which will decrease lipid level. Like example, lovastatin, they inhibit one enzyme known as HMG-CoA reductase. They inhibit one enzyme HMG-CoA reductase. All enzymes, they end with the word ACE. Okay, similarly, many other drugs are there, like neostigmine. Neostigmine, it inhibits the enzyme acetylcholine esterase. In which fashion? Reversible fashion. Acetylcholine esterase. But remember, there is a drug which inhibit this same enzyme in an irreversible fashion. That same enzyme is inhibited in an irreversible fashion is organophosphates. Organophosphates, they are suicide inhibitor of acetylcholine esterase. Okay. Similarly, if we go further, remember all non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, NSAIDs, all non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, they inhibit one enzyme, cyclooxygenase. Cyclooxygenase enzyme reversibly, which is sometimes known as COX enzyme. Except one NSAID, that is aspirin. Aspirin is the only NSAID which inhibit COX enzyme in an irreversible fashion. In an irreversible fashion. Okay, so aspirin. So if you want to remember other examples, they are not much important, but just remember all ACE inhibitors, these drugs, they end with the word pril, like captopril. So they inhibit one enzyme, angiotensin, one convertase enzyme inhibitor. Angiotensin 1 convertase enzyme inhibitor, they all inhibit reversibly. Okay, similarly, you can write among irreversible, you can write one more examples, that is proton pump inhibitor. All proton pump inhibitors are irreversible inhibitor. All proton pump inhibitors, they are irreversible inhibitor of hydrogen potassium ATPase enzyme. Okay. Now the point is, remember, this proton pump inhibitor, they are inhibiting hydrogen potassium ATPase. And remember, this is an enzyme as well as transporter. It is an enzyme as well as transporter. Okay. So remember, they are irreversible inhibitor of hydrogen potassium ATPase. So this enzyme function as a transporter as well. Okay. So just remember these drugs, which are irreversible inhibitors. So this is all about the targets of the drug apart from receptors. Okay. Now we'll be talking about receptors. Hello friends, now today we will be discussing about receptors. Okay, so as we had discussed that there are on a cell, there are four kinds of receptors. There are four types of receptors which are present on a cell. Okay, out of these four types, remember, the three are present on cell membrane. Three are present on the cell membrane, and the fourth receptor is present inside the cell. So receptor is of four types. Three are present on cell membrane, fourth one is present inside the cell. Let's write their names. The first receptor which is present on cell membrane is known as ligand gated ion channel. That is ligand gated ion channel. Okay, ligand gated ion channel. These receptors are also known as ionotropic receptors. Why? Because they conduct ions. They are also known as ionotropic receptors. Second we have is G protein coupled receptors, which are present on cell membrane. The second one which is present on cell membrane is G protein coupled receptor. Coupled receptors. Okay. So we call them as GPCR in short form, G protein coupled receptor. Now remember, they are also known as metabotrophic receptors. They are also known as metabotrophic receptors. Now why they are known as metabotrophic receptors? Because they act through second messengers. Because they act through second messengers. That is why they are known as metabotrophic receptors. Okay. Now what is second messenger? We will come to know that. Third one you will write, which is present on cell membrane, which is present on cell membrane. The third one is enzyme linked receptor. Enzyme linked receptor. Okay. And they are also known as protein kinase receptor. प्रोटीन काइनेज रिसेप्टर्स. नाउ रिमेंबर दे आर ऑल्सो नोन एज ग्रोथ रिसेप्टर्स. दे आर ऑल्सो नोन एज ग्रोथ रिसेप्टर्स. एंड द फोर्थ रिसेप्टर विच इज प्रेजेंट इनसाइड द सेल इज नोन एज इंट्रासेल्यूलर रिसेप्टर. इंट्रासेल्यूलर रिसेप्टर्स ओके. दे आर ऑल्सो नोन एज न्यूक्लियर रिसेप्टर्स. दे आर ऑल्सो नोन एज न्यूक्लियर रिसेप्टर्स ओके. बट द बेटर टर्म इज इंट्रासेल्यूलर रिसेप्टर बिकॉज वी विल डिस्कस दैट दे कैन बी प्रेजेंट इनसाइड द न्यूक्लियस. दे कैन बी प्रेजेंट इनसाइड द सेल ऑल्सो, इनसाइड द साइटोप्लाज्म ऑल्सो. सो दीज आर द फोर रिसेप्टर्स टाइप्स विच आर प्रेजेंट ऑन अ सेल. सो फर्स्ट थ्री आर प्रेजेंट ऑन सेल मेम्ब्रेन एंड द फोर्थ वन इज प्रेजेंट इनसाइड द सेल. सो लेट्स डिस्कस अबाउट द फर्स्ट वन. यू विल डिस्कस देम वन बाय वन. सो लेट्स डिस्कस अबाउट आइनोट्रॉपिक और लाइगेंड गेटेड आयन चैनल ओके. सो कैन वी से लेट्स टॉक अबाउट द फर्स्ट वन लाइगेंड गेटेड आयन चैनल. लेट्स सी व्हाट इज द स्ट्रक्चर लाइगेंड गेटेड आयन चैनल ओके. सो दे आर प्रेजेंट ऑन सेल मेम्ब्रेन. सो सपोज दिस इज अ सेल मेम्ब्रेन. लेट्स सी व्हाट इज द स्ट्रक्चर. रिमेंबर वी कैन डिटरमाइन द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ एनी प्रोटीन. ऑल दीज रिसेप्टर्स आर प्रोटीन. वी कैन डिटरमाइन द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ एनी प्रोटीन बाय अ टेक्नोलॉजी और टेक्निक नोन एज एक्सरे क्रिस्टलोग्राफी. सो इट्स अ टेक्निक बाय विच वी कैन आइडेंटिफाई द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ एनी प्रोटीन ओके. सो वी कैन डिटरमाइन द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ ऑल दीज फोर टाइप्स ऑफ रिसेप्टर्स. नाउ If we talk about these receptor, the first receptor which we made, which we discovered was nicotinic receptor. It was the first receptor to be discovered. So we will discuss about the shape of nicotinic receptors. Okay. Now what is the shape of ligand gated ion channel? Their shape is just like a flower, a rose like flower. And we make five subunits or five petals of that rose. Five petals of that rose. Okay. So it is just like a rose okay. So it is present on a cell membrane and the shape is like a rose, and these rose has most of the time five subunits. We name this subunit as alpha, beta, gamma, delta, epsilon, etc okay. We name this. So the shape of this receptor is, you will write, pentameric. Why? Because it has five unit, or rosette type. Rosette, because it is just like a rose okay. Now this is the structure. Now how do they function? You write, how do they function? Remember, as they are known as ligand gated ion channel. So if the ligand is any molecule which will bind to its receptor, this ligand, it will come and suppose it binds to alpha beta subunit most of the time okay. It comes and bind. When this ligand, it comes and bind to this receptor, it simply opens this receptor. This opens the receptor, and between them, you will write, it will open the pore of receptor. Okay. When this pore, between them, there is a pore. This pore gets open. Remember, the ions which are present outside the cell will come inside. It will lead to ion influx. So ion will come inside. Okay. So most of the times the ions which comes inside, the positively charged ions like sodium, calcium, they will come inside. And when any positive charge it comes inside, remember, the cell becomes depolarized. The cell becomes depolarized and the cell becomes excitatory. Okay. And sometimes what happens, certain times a negative charge also comes inside, chloride, negative chloride. Remember, when negative charge comes inside, the cell becomes hyperpolarized. The cell becomes hyperpolarized and the cell becomes inhibitory. It becomes inhibitory. Okay, so cell will stop functioning. So remember, when positive charge moves inside the cell starts functioning. When negative charge comes inside the cell stops functioning. Okay. So they can conduct various ions like sodium, calcium, chloride, etc. Okay, so can we say the function is due to, when ligand will come, it is due to movement of ions, or there will be ion influx. That is why they are also known as ionotropic receptors. They are also known as ionotropic receptors. Okay, now can we say the final effect is directly due to ions only? The ions which are coming from outside, they are either making a cell function or making a cell inhibiting a cell. So remember that these receptors, if we talk about their properties, you will write among all four receptor, ligand-gated, G-protein, enzyme-linked, and intracellular, ionotropic receptor or ligand-gated ion channel, they are the fastest acting receptor, and their action comes in milliseconds. They are the fastest acting receptor overall. And you will write, inside the cell, we don't need any other molecule to produce effect. They can directly produce effect by acting on receptors. So you will write, no second messenger is involved. But we will discuss about GPCR. In GPCR, second messenger will be involved. So here, no second messenger is involved. And you will write that these receptors, they are the fastest acting receptor as well. Okay. So let's talk about the examples of various ionotropic receptors. So the first example is, you will write, the receptor of acetylcholine is nicotinic receptor of acetylcholine is an ionotropic receptor. Okay, but in bracket you will write a very important point. You will write, not muscarinic receptor. There is one more receptor of acetylcholine, muscarinic. Remember, nicotinic receptors are ionotropic, muscarinic are GPCR. They are not ionotropic receptor, they are GPCR. Second example you will write, serotonin. Remember, another name of serotonin is 5-hydroxytryptamine. Serotonin is also known as 5-hydroxytryptamine. It's another name. So the receptors of serotonin are known as 5-HT receptor, HNT. And you will write, 5-HT3 receptor is an ionotropic receptor. So these are the examples of ionotropic receptor. But remember, serotonin has many other receptors like 5-HT1 to 5-HT7. So remember, it has overall 7 receptors. Remember, all receptors apart from, except 5-HT3, all other 5-HT receptor 1, 2, except 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, they all are GPCR. Okay? So only 5-HT3 receptor is an ionotropic receptor. Third example you will write is glutamate receptor. Remember, glutamate is an excitatory neurotransmitter in our brain. It has 3 receptors, NMDA, AMPA, and kinate receptors. And remember, they all are ionotropic receptors. Now remember, till now, these 3 receptors which we have discussed, remember, they conduct sodium, and hence all these receptors are excitatory receptors. Okay, so nicotinic is an excitatory receptor. You'll write that 5-HT3 is also excitatory. Glutamate is also an excitatory neurotransmitter in our brain. The fourth receptor we will write is a receptor of a neurotransmitter in our brain, GABA. Remember, GABA, it acts on a brain, and it acts on GABA-A chloride channel. Can you tell me that GABA-A receptor or GABA-A chloride channel will be an excitatory or inhibitory receptor? Remember, it is conducting chloride. And if negative charge comes inside, remember, that is why GABA is a inhibitory neurotransmitter in our brain, because when it acts on its receptor, inside the neuron, chloride comes. And when negative charge comes inside the neuron becomes inhibited. Okay? But remember, there is one more receptor of GABA. Another receptor of GABA is GABA B receptor. GABA B receptor. We have written GABA A. Remember, GABA A is an inotropic receptor. GABA A is an inotropic receptor. GABA B again is a GPCR. So it is also a G protein coupled receptor. Okay, so these are the examples of inotropic receptor. So let's recapitulate. Acetylcholine, nicotinic receptor, not muscarinic. Muscarinic is GPCR. Serotonin, only 5-HT3 receptor. Rest all other are GPCR. All glutamate receptors, NMDA, AMPA, kinate receptors, GABA receptors, GABA A chloride channel, that is, as it is conducting chloride. So we will write that it is an inhibitory receptor, except GABA B. GABA B is a GPCR. Okay. So let's make another heading of next receptor in our brain, in our body, is GPCR. So let's write about now GPCR. Okay. So GPCR stands for G protein coupled receptors. Okay. Remember, they are also known as metabotrophic receptors. Metabotrophic receptors. Why they are known as metabotrophic receptors? Because they act through second messengers. They cannot produce effect directly. They produce indirect effect with the help of certain other chemicals. Okay. Now, let's see what is the structure. Let's see what is the structure. So, suppose this is a cell membrane. This is a cell membrane. As you are seeing the word G protein coupled receptor. So there is a receptor. Suppose this is a receptor. Okay, this is the receptor portion which we have made. Okay. Now this is the receptor portion which we have made. That means the ligand will come and bind to this receptor portion. And if you can see the structure of this receptor portion, it is just like a snake with how many helix? You are seeing 7 helix. So this receptor has a structure of, you will write, 7 transmembrane. 7 transmembrane helical domain. Sorry, helical. Helical structure, which is sometimes known as serpentine helical, just like a snake. Serpentine helical. Okay, so how many loops it is mating or helix it is mating? 7. Remember the word 7, it is important for you. Okay, now this is the receptor portion. Now remember, when a ligand will come, it will act on this receptor portion only. And when it acts on its receptor, a little bit far away, there is a protein which is attached to the cell membrane. There is a protein which is attached to the cell membrane. Let's call it as G protein. There is a protein which is on a cell membrane. We call it as G protein. Hence the full form comes G protein coupled receptor. That is why they are known as G protein coupled receptor. Okay. Now, what is the structure and function of G protein? Remember, when ligand will come and bind to this receptor portion, this receptor will activate G protein. And inside the cell, the effect is produced by G protein. The effect will be produced by G protein. Okay. So it needs to activate this receptor. When bind to this ligand will bind to receptor, this receptor will modify G protein and G protein will produce effect inside the cell. So let's see what is the structure of G protein. Okay. So let's see first what is the structure of G protein, then we will discuss how it will produce effect inside the cell. Okay. Now remember, G protein, when it is inactive, when it is not functioning, then the structure of this G protein is just like, we will write, at inactive state, this G protein, it has three subunit. Okay. You will write these three subunit as alpha, beta, gamma. In inactive state or resting state, This G protein has three subunit, alpha, beta, gamma, and at the tail of this alpha subunit, there is a protein which is attached. This alpha subunit, it contains one molecule GDP. There is a molecule which is attached to alpha subunit, that is GDP. Okay, so this GDP is attached to alpha subunit. So can we say that at inactive state, when it is not functioning, G protein is a heterotrimer. Hetero means different subunit, trimer means three subunit, and heterotrimer of alpha, beta, gamma, they all are attached themselves. And at that alpha subunit, what is attached? GDP molecule is attached. This is the inactive state. Now what happens when this ligand comes and bind to this receptor activate this G protein. This receptor activate G protein, and this G protein will become into active form. It will get converted into active form. Now let's see what is the active form of G protein. How this G protein will become active? Remember, the active form of G protein is this alpha subunit. This alpha subunit, it will become separated from beta and gamma. This alpha subunit becomes separated from beta and gamma, and at the tail of this alpha subunit, this GDP gets converted into GTP. Okay, this alpha subunit will become, the GDP will become converted into GTP. So can we say in active form, alpha subunit becomes separated from beta and gamma, and alpha subunit, it rather contains GTP. Okay, so at inactive state, alpha contains GDP, and at active form, it will contain GTP. Okay, so remember, now what will happen? Now sir, this alpha subunit which contains GTP, remember this alpha is the active form of GTP. This alpha is the active form. How it is active form? So this alpha subunit, it will donate its phosphate group. It will donate its phosphate group, and it will lead to phosphorylation of proteins or enzymes. It leads to phosphorylation of enzymes inside the cell. It will lead to phosphorylation of enzyme inside the cell. So can we say GTP has three phosphate? It has three phosphate. It will donate its one of the phosphate, and it will convert back into GDP. Okay, so when it will donate its one of the phosphate group inside the cell, it will again come back to GDP, and it will again come back to its resting state. Okay, so can we say in active form, this alpha subunit contains GTP, in inactive form it contains GDP. Because of this reason, they are known as G protein. Why they are known as G protein? Because they contain GDP or GTP. And among alpha, beta and gamma, can you tell me which is the active form of G protein? Remember, alpha subunit is the active form of G protein because it is producing effect inside the cell. Okay, now what effect it will produce inside the cell? It will cause phosphorylation of proteins. So let's say what will happen inside the cell now. Okay, what will happen inside the cell? So can we say that this alpha has donated its phosphate? Now it will cause phosphorylation of enzyme. Okay, now which enzyme it is phosphorylating, on this basis these G protein are further classified. Okay, which enzymes they are phosphorylating, on this property these G proteins are further divided into four types. Okay, so you will write types of G protein. Either they are, we will write G alpha S type, G alpha Q type, G alpha I type, and G alpha 12 and 13 type. Okay, so remember, can we say G alpha was the active subunit? So this G alpha is either of S type or of Q type or of I type or of 12-13 type. So these are the different types of G alpha subunit. Okay. Now, on what basis we have classified into four types? On the types on which enzyme they are donating their phosphate group. Remember, if it is G alpha S type, S, it phosphorylate an enzyme known as adenyl cyclase. It will phosphorylate one enzyme, adenyl cyclase. Okay, so you will write, it will phosphorylate adenyl cyclase. Remember, when any enzymes becomes phosphorylated, in any enzyme, when we attach a phosphate group, this enzyme becomes active. It starts functioning. So it leads to activation of or phosphorylation of adenyl cyclase, while in certain tissues it leads to activation of guanyl cyclase, a similar enzyme. Okay, it will lead to activation of adenyl cyclase or in some tissue guanyl cyclase. Okay, if it is of GQ type, remember, it causes activation of phospholipase C. Okay, so it also leads to activation of phospholipase C. If it is of GI type, you will write, it leads to, so GQ type causes activation of phospholipase C. Okay, now if it is of GI type, it causes inhibition of, it causes inhibition of adenyl cyclase. So I for inhibition, remember, I for inhibition. Now, if it is of G alpha 12 and 13, sir, we don't know much about 12 and 13, but you will write, if it is of G alpha 12 and 13, it causes activation of Rho kinase enzyme. It causes activation of Rho kinase enzyme. We don't know much about 12 and 13, but you will write 2-3 points, because after that we will not discuss about 12 and 13. Rho kinase activation, what is the effect it will lead to? Remember, it causes cell growth or cell division, and it causes smooth muscle contraction. These are the two effects which we till now know about G alpha 12 and 13. Okay, so after that we will, and it activates which enzyme? Rho kinase. So we will not discuss about G alpha 12 and 13, because in pharmacology we don't have any drug which will act on G alpha. Okay, so let's focus on the first three we will discuss about G alpha S type, Q type and I type. Okay, now can you tell me, among G alpha S, Q and I, remember, GS and GQ, they are excitatory GPCR, they are excitatory G protein, because they are making a cell excite, because they are causing activation of enzyme, while GI is an inhibitory G protein. It is an inhibitory G protein. The cell will stop functioning. Let's see how they will produce effect. Now, sir, if we say that GS type has activated adenyl cyclase enzyme, remember, adenyl cyclase inside the cell increases the level of cyclic AMP. Adenyl cyclase inside the cell increases cyclic AMP level. Guanyl cyclase enzyme inside the cell increases the level of cyclic GMP. Okay, if it is phospholipase C, it will increase the level of IP3DAG. What is that? We will discuss shortly. IP3DAG. Can we say, if adenyl cyclase is inhibited, what level of which molecule will decrease? It will decrease the level of cyclic AMP. Now remember, so these molecules are the final molecule which will produce effect inside the cell. okay, and these molecules are hence known as second messengers. These molecules are hence known as second messengers. Okay, so cyclic AMP, cyclic GMP, IP3 DAG, they are known as second messenger. So remember their name, because they will produce effect inside the cell. So these are the second messengers. Now let's see what effect they will produce. So the effect what is produced by them depends upon the various tissue. If it is muscle, it will cause muscle contraction. If it is liver, it will start for producing bile or enzymes. It depends upon the tissue. But their effect, we have made a summary of their effect. Remember, the effect which is produced by increase in cyclic AMP is also known as activation of protein kinase A pathway. We call the effect which is produced by cyclic AMP is known as activation of protein kinase A pathway. Okay, so let's write the short form as PKA. Okay, protein kinase A pathway. If it is cyclic GMP, the effect which is produced by cyclic GMP is known as activation of protein kinase G pathway. Protein kinase G pathway. We call it as PKG. PKG pathway. If it is IP3 DAG, we call it as activation of protein kinase C pathway. Protein kinase C pathway. Okay, we call it as PKC. Now remember, this PKC pathway is carried out by DAG. You are seeing we have written here two molecule. This DAG causes protein kinase C pathway, and IP3 it causes activation of calcium calmodulin pathway. Calcium calmodulin pathway. It is caused by IP3. Okay, we will come to that. Okay, so it increases calcium level, and that calcium causes activation of calmodulin pathway. Remember, this calcium is sometimes known as third messenger, because first it increases calcium level and calcium increases calmodulin pathway. Okay, this is by IP3. And if it is cyclic AMP decrease, you will write it will not cause any activation of pathway. You will write it will open potassium channels. It will open potassium channel. Now remember one point. Remember, most of the potassium which is present in our body is inside the cell. And if potassium channels, they become open, this potassium will move outside the cell. And remember, if positive charge moves outside the cell becomes hyperpolarized. And hence, the cell will become inhibited. The cell will become inhibited. So it will open potassium channel and it will cause hyperpolarization of cells. Okay, so this is the final summary of G protein. Okay, so cyclic AMP, cyclic GMP. So let's write one point about these pathway. Okay, so let's discuss a little bit extra point about G alpha S subunit. Okay, G alpha S type. So can we say G alpha S type, they activate what molecule? Adenyl cyclase or guanyl cyclase. Okay, now what is the function of adenyl cyclase? Remember, adenyl cyclase, they increase cyclic AMP level, which we have already discussed. Okay, which we have already discussed. How? Because adenyl cyclase start the conversion of ATP. Causes an enzymatic conversion of ATP into cyclic AMP. It converts ATP into cyclic AMP. And if it is guanyl cyclase, remember, if it is guanyl cyclase will convert GTP into cyclic GMP. GTP into cyclic GMP. Okay. Now, remember one point, there is a drug which can directly stimulate guanyl cyclase. There is a drug which can directly stimulate guanyl cyclase, and this chemical is also produced in our body, that is nitric oxide. So nitric oxide does not act on receptors, it can directly act on enzymes. Okay, so nitric oxide can do same thing. Okay, it can directly stimulate guanyl cyclase and it can stimulate the intracellular effect of GS type of pathway. Okay, now remember, when these molecule, they produce effect, these molecule, they produce effect. We know that these molecule produce effect inside the cell by PKA pathway and PKG pathway. Now after some times these molecules, they become degraded. These molecules, they become degraded and their action is over, and the action is terminated or over. So the how the action of these cyclic AMP and cyclic GMP is terminated or gets over, remember, these molecules are degraded with the help of one enzyme. That enzyme is, both of these molecules, they are degraded by an enzyme known as phosphodiesterase enzyme. There is an enzyme present in our cell, phosphodiesterase enzyme, in short form PDE. This enzymes, it degrades cyclic AMP and cyclic GMP. How it degrades? It opens its cyclical structure and it will become 5-AMP and 5-GMP. Their cyclical structure is over and they are inactive molecule. Okay, remember, cyclic AMP and GMP, they are active molecule, they can produce effect inside the cell. They are degraded by an enzyme, phosphodiesterase enzyme, and their action is terminated or gets over. Okay, now remember, we have developed a class of drug which will inhibit phosphodiesterase enzyme. So that class of a drug is known as phosphodiesterase inhibitors. Can we say phosphodiesterase inhibitors, their mechanism of action is, they inhibit this enzyme, hence they will increase the level of cyclic AMP and cyclic GMP inside the cell. They increase the level of cyclic AMP and cyclic GMP inside the cell. Okay, so this is a class of a drug which will inhibit this enzyme, phosphodiesterase enzyme. Okay, so I'll give you a list of phosphodiesterase inhibitors. Okay, you can write phosphodiesterase inhibitor, PDE inhibitors. Okay, so remember, there are various types of phosphodiesterase enzyme, different times. You'll write non-selective phosphodiesterase inhibitors, then you will write selective phosphodiesterase inhibitors. Among non-selective one, you can write, the drug is theophylline, which is used in asthma. Okay, and caffeine also. Next, you can write is pentoxifilin. It is used in Berger's disease. Selective, you can write phosphodiesterase 1 inhibitor. You can write a drug vinpocetine. This vinpocetine is used in Alzheimer's disease. Okay, then you will write phosphodiesterase 3 inhibitor. You can write the name of a drug, anagrelide. Okay, anagrelide, it is used as an antiplatelet drug. Okay, you can write one more drug, celostazole. It is also used as an antiplatelet drug. Okay, celostazole, it is also used as an antiplatelet drug. Then you will write phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitors. Okay, you will write rolipram, roflumilast. Remember, rolipram and roflumilast, they are used in asthma. They are antiplatelet. They are used in asthma. Okay, many other drugs are also, like celomilast, apremilast, ibudilast. You are seeing they are having a similar name. They are used in various condition like psoriasis, etc. Okay, psoriasis. Then we have you'll write drotaverine. Drotaverine is used in colicky pain. Okay, colicky pain. Then you will write phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors. You can write a drug dipyridamole. It is used as an antiplatelet. Then you will write sildenafil, tadalafil, avanafil, vardenafil. Remember, they are ending with a similar name. Okay, they are used in the treatment of impotency and pulmonary artery hypertension. Pulmonary artery hypertension and impotency. Okay, just remember, sildenafil, apart from 5, it is also 6 inhibitor. Sildenafil also inhibits 6 enzyme. And you can write one phosphodiesterase 10 inhibitor. The drug is papaverine. This papaverine is also used in impotency, also used for the treatment of impotency. Okay, so this is a small list of the drugs which you must remember, important drug which you must remember. Okay, phosphodiesterase inhibitor. So phosphodiesterase non-selective, we have discussed theophylline and caffeine and pentoxifilin. 1, vinpocetine. 3, you can write anagrelide, celestrazole. Then we have phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitor, 5 inhibitors and 10 inhibitors. These drugs at least you must remember. Okay, and all these drugs, they increase the level of cyclic AMP and GMP. Okay, now let's talk about the GQ type of receptors. GQ type. Okay, now G alpha Q type of receptor, remember, it causes activation or phosphorylation of which protein, which enzyme? If you remember, phospholipase enzyme, phospholipase C enzyme. Okay, now remember, when this phospholipase C enzymes becomes activated, remember, it will break phospholipids. And remember, phospholipids, they are present on our cell membrane. Phospholipids, they are present in our cell membrane. So when phospholipase enzyme will become activated, it breaks down phospholipids. When these phospholipids are broken down, one phospholipid will come inside the cell and the second phospholipid will remain on the cell membrane. Remember, one phospholipid will come inside the cell, IP3, and one will remain on the cell membrane itself, DAG. Okay, so it leads to increase in level of IP3 DAG. Okay, now what is this IP3? IP3 stands for inositol triphosphate, because P3 stands for 3-phosphate. Okay, and it is the active form. And DAG stands for diacylglycerol. Diacylglycerol, it is also an active form. Now what is the purpose? Remember, diacylglycerol, it activates one pathway known as protein kinase C pathway. Protein kinase C pathway, and it will produce effect inside the cell. Okay, and what about IP3? Remember, this IP3 is the active form. This IP3 will donate its phosphate group, and this phosphate group, when it is donated, it releases calcium. It causes release of calcium from smooth endoplasmic reticulum, and this calcium activate one calmodulin pathway. It activates calmodulin pathway. Okay, and remember, this calcium is hence known as third messenger. Okay, IP3 and DAG, they are known as second messenger, calcium is known as third messenger. So what is the active form? Active form is IP3. Now remember, when it donates its phosphate group, it gets converted into IP2, inositol diphosphate. Inositol diphosphate. Remember, inositol diphosphate is inactive form. It cannot function. It is inactive form. So what is the active form? IP2. Now what will happen? Remember, what will happen? This IP2 will get converted into IP, that is monophosphate. Okay, again it is inactive. It will get converted into only I. I stand for inositol, only I, and this I goes to phospholipid, and again it will form phospholipid. It will again form phospholipids. Okay, now remember, there is a kind of a drug, there is a drug which inhibit these two pathway, only these two pathway. Can we say it will inhibit resynthesis of inositol? There is a drug which inhibit resynthesis of inositol. And can we say all of the inositol will remain in IP2 form and in an inactive form, and the cell will not able to function? All of the inositol will remain in IP2 form. The drug which inhibit resynthesis of inositol in our body is lithium. So lithium, remember, it inhibit resynthesis of inositol, and all of the inositol will become accumulated at inactive form. Okay, it will become accumulated in inactive form. Okay, because it is inhibiting the conversion of IP2 into IP and into inositol. So the level of IP2 will increase, which is an inactive form. Again, phospholipids will not form, and again this receptor will not able to act. Okay, so remember, this drug lithium inhibit resynthesis of inositol. Okay, now just discuss about certain properties of GPCR, and we will discuss about certain examples of GPCR. So first, many examples we have already discussed. So let's first discuss about examples. We already know muscarinic receptors, muscarinic acetylcholine receptors, they are GPCR. We also know serotonin receptor. All receptor from 5-HT1 to 5-HT7, except which one? Except 5-HT3. Okay, then you can write GABA B receptor. Now apart from this, you will write all sympathetic nervous system receptors are GPCR. Okay, all sympathetic receptors. Sympathetic receptors are further divided into alpha and beta. They all are GPCR. Similarly, you will write dopamine receptors. They are GPCR. You will also write histamine receptor. Remember, dopamine has D1 to D5 receptors. Okay. Histamine, it has H1 to H4 receptors. All are GPCR. Then you will write vasopressin receptor. Okay, vasopressin is also known as ADH hormone. It has V1 to V3 receptor, all are GPCR. Then you will write opioid receptors are mu, kappa, delta, etc. They all are GPCR. And you will write all hypothalamic hormones, like hypothalamic hormone, they are releasing factors like growth hormone releasing hormone, gonadotropin releasing hormone, TSH releasing hormone. So they all are GPCR. Okay, similarly they act on pituitary. Okay, remember, all pituitary hormones are GPCR except growth hormone and prolactin. So in this whole, hypothalamic and pituitary axis hormone, all are GPCR except these two, growth hormone and prolactin. Growth hormone and prolactin, we will discuss, they are enzyme linked receptor, which we will be discussing after GPCR. They are enzyme linked receptors, okay? And you can write with pituitary, posterior pituitary hormone, oxytocin also is a GPCR, oxytocin. So in one word, we will write now. So these receptors, remember, are the exception among hypothalamic pituitary axis hormone. So you will write that among GPCR, you will write the properties of GPCR, they are the largest family of receptors. They are the largest family of receptors. Okay. They are the largest family of receptors. So this is a very important point you must remember. Okay. Largest family of receptors. Now, this GPCR, they have a certain properties. Okay. Now the point is, sir, these GPCR, they have certain properties. We will discuss these property little bit down. So let's discuss their property. The first property of this GPCR is promiscuity. The first property is promiscuity of ligand. Okay. Now the point is, what do we mean by promiscuity of ligand? I told you that a ligand, it comes and it activates a receptor. This receptor is activated by ligand. When a ligand comes, it activates a receptor. Now remember, this ligand can bind to, it is not loyal to one type of receptor. This ligand is promiscuous. Promiscuous means this ligand is not loyal to one type of GPCR. It can bind to multiple type of GPCR. Promiscuity of ligand means this ligand is promiscuous. Promiscuous means multiple partners. So remember, one ligand can bind to multiple type of GPCR. Multiple types of GPCR. Okay. Example, let's take an example. There is a molecule known as adrenaline. Adrenaline is a sympathetic hormone. Remember, this adrenaline can bind to alpha receptors and beta receptors. And this alpha receptor is further divided into alpha 1, alpha 2. Beta is further divided into beta 1, beta 2 and beta 3. Remember, this alpha 1 receptor is of GQ type. This alpha 2 is of GI type. And all beta receptors are of GS type. Okay, so IP3 DAG, inhibitory GS. So can we say this one adrenaline can bind to multiple types of GPCR? It is not loyal to one type of GPCR. This is known as promiscuity of ligand. Okay, now second property of GPCR is, so these GPCR, they show the property of desensitization. They show the property of desensitization and they also show the property of supersensitivity. They also show the property of supersensitivity. Now, what do we mean by desensitization? Desensitization means if there is continuous ligand exposure, these GPCR will stop functioning. They will become tired. They will stop functioning. That means if we continuously stimulate one GPCR, if we continuously stimulate one GPCR by giving a ligand from outside continuously, if they are continuously stimulated, remember, these GPCR after some time will stop functioning. And this stop functioning, can we say it will lead to decrease in response or effect? They will lead to decrease in response. Why? Because they have become desensitized. They have stopped functioning. That means they have become desensitized. Okay. And this desensitization is also known as development of tolerance. This desensitization is also known as development of tolerance. So let's take an example of this. The classical example is opioids. If a person continuously taken morphine, remember opioids, they show development of tolerance. Okay, development of tolerance, because these opioid receptor, if a person takes opioid continuously, these receptors will stop functioning after a while. Okay, and the response decreases. It will lead to decrease in responses is known as tolerance. Hence, a person will take high amount of opioid and the person will become addict. Similarly, alcohol. Remember, alcohol can act on various receptors like glutamate. It can also act on opioid. Hence, remember, there are certain drugs which may show cross tolerance. Okay, which is also known as cross desensitization, So one ligand can bind to multiple type of GPCR. Because of this reason, remember, one ligand can produce cross tolerance. Okay, so remember, alcohol causes tolerance in opioid patient also. Now, what do we mean by supersensitivity? Supersensitivity means if this receptor is blocked, from ligand, this ligand is not able to act on this receptor for long duration of time, and now when this blocker is removed and when this ligand will act on this receptor, this GPCR, if they are blocked from very long duration of time and after a certain duration of time, if they get a chance to function, they produce exaggerated response. If it is blocked from ligand and it is not functioning, it was not functioning from long duration of time, and now if this GPCR gets a chance to produce function, you have removed this blocker, if this GPCR now gets a chance to produce function, remember, this GPCR will produce exaggerated response. This is known as supersensitivity. Okay, they will produce supersensitivity. Okay, now why it occurs? Because it occurs due to upregulation. It will lead to upregulation of receptors. Okay, and why desensitization occurs? It occurs due to downregulation of receptors. Okay, so if a GPCR was not functioning from very long duration of time, it has lot of energy, it will produce exaggerated response. If it is functioning continuously, it will become tired, it will stop functioning. It is known as desensitization. Let's take an example of desensitization and supersensitivity. So in desensitization, you will write, there is a hormone known as gonadotropin releasing hormone. Remember, when gonadotropin releasing hormones, they are given continuously, when this gonadotropin releasing hormone, they generally act on pituitary, and pituitary, they release FSH and LH hormone in response to gonadotropin releasing hormone, which was synthesized from hypothalamus. Now remember, when this gonadotropin releasing hormone is given intermittently, okay, when it is given intermittently like this, it increases the synthesis of FSH and LH. This pituitary increases FSH and LH release. But when this gonadotropin releasing hormone is given continuously, it decreases FSH and LH production. Why? Because gonadotropin releasing hormone is a GPCR. Its receptor which is present on pituitary is GPCR receptor. Now remember, when you give GnRH hormone continuously to your patient, it will act on the receptor and this receptor will become desensitized. Because of desensitization of receptors, this gonadotropin releasing hormone will not able to produce FSH and LH. Why? Because of desensitization of receptor. Okay, so remember, gonadotropin releasing hormone, if it is given continuously for long duration of time, this GnRH hormone rather suppresses FSH and LH, and when it is given pulsatile way or intermittently, it increases FSH and LH. So can you tell me, in our body normally, how gonadotropin releasing hormone is secreted in our body? Remember, normally in our body it is secreted like this. Okay, it is secreted normally. Okay, but when we give as a drug, we can suppress the production of FSH and LH by giving them continuously. Okay, so we will see its application later on. Okay, so remember, this is a very important example. Now let's talk about the example of super sensitivity. So when we have blocked this GPCR for long duration of time, they will stop function. They are not functioning for long duration of time. When they will give a chance, they will function in an exaggerated manner. So let's see the example. The example is, you will write never stop beta blocker suddenly in your patient. Never stop beta blocker suddenly in the patient. Now remember, beta receptor on our heart, there is one beta receptor. If you have blocked this beta receptor by giving a beta blocker, if you have blocked this beta receptor on the heart, remember, the heart is not able to function. So it will decrease heart rate. So beta blocker, they block beta 1 receptor on heart, and the heart does not beat fast. Now suppose a person has missed the dose, or due to some reason you have stopped the beta blocker suddenly. Can we say that these beta receptors are GPCR? There is now no beta receptor. If this adrenaline will come, which is present in the body, this adrenaline will stimulate beta 1 receptor, and this beta receptor will produce an exaggerated response. Why? Because these beta receptors were not functioning for long duration of time, they have become super sensitive. Because earlier they were blocked for long duration of time, now a person has missed the dose of beta blocker, these GPCR will become super sensitive, they will produce exaggerated response. Can we say the heart rate will shoot up? So there will be increase in heart rate, which will lead to arrhythmias. Okay, very high heart rate. So sudden stoppage of beta blocker will lead to arrhythmias. Can we say in the high heart rate, the demand of the heart will also be more, oxygen and nutritional requirement? It will lead to MI, myocardial infarction, and a patient may die suddenly. Okay, so remember, never stop beta blockers suddenly in your patient. You can write one more example of super sensitivity. You'll write, there is a disease known as tardive dyskinesia. It is due to super sensitivity of dopamine receptors. Why it occurs? Because you have blocked dopamine receptors by antipsychotic drug. They block dopamine receptor, and if you have blocked dopamine receptor for long duration of time, these dopamine receptor, they become super sensitive, and they cause blockage of dopamine receptor. Because of super sensitivity, they produce one disease known as tardive dyskinesia. It is due to super sensitivity of dopamine receptor because they were blocked by antipsychotic drug for long duration of time. Okay, so this is the properties of GPCR. Okay, now let's discuss about the third type of receptor, that is enzyme linked receptor. Okay, enzyme linked receptors. Enzyme linked receptors, they are also known as protein kinase receptor. They are also known as growth receptors. Okay. Now, let's see what is the structure. They are also present on cell membrane. So, suppose this is a cell membrane. Okay. Now, as the name implies, enzyme which is linked to a receptor. So, suppose this is a receptor portion. This is the receptor portion. Okay. So, this receptor you will write is a transmembrane protein. Transmembrane means it is present on cell membrane. Transmembrane protein. Now, on this receptor portion below, there is an enzyme which is linked. There is an enzyme which is linked. Okay, so that is why they are known as enzyme linked receptor. So, this is the structure. So, they have a transmembrane receptor portion and an enzyme which is linked to the tail of this receptor. Okay, now these enzymes are kinase enzyme. These enzymes are kinase enzyme. That is why it is known as protein kinase receptor. Okay, that is why it is known as protein kinase receptor. Now let's see how do they function. Now what happens when ligand will come? Suppose this is a ligand. Here in this case, suppose we need two ligand. We need two ligand. This ligand, they will come and bind to their respective receptor portion. Okay. So first effect is ligand binding. Now when this ligand binds to this receptor portion, it leads to dimerization of receptor. It leads to dimerization of receptor. Or in one word, you will write it leads to fusion of receptor. Now, what do we mean by the word dimerization or fusion of receptor? When ligand it will come and bind to this receptor, it will these two receptor portion they will come and attach among themselves. They will become fused. Okay. Now, when they will become fused, remember the enzyme which is present on, let's say, on the right side will activate the enzyme which is present on left side. And the enzyme which is present on left will activate the enzyme which is present on right. So it will lead to second step, you will write autophosphorylation of enzyme. Autophosphorylation of enzyme. Okay, and this enzyme will become active. This enzyme will become active. Okay, so first is dimerization or fusion of these two receptor portion, and then there will be autophosphorylation or activation of enzyme. Okay, now when this enzyme will become activated, the effect which is produced inside the cell is cell division. The effect which is produced inside the cell is cell division. That is why they are also known as growth receptors. Why they are known as growth receptors? Because they produce cell division. Now remember, how do they produce effect inside the cell? By cell division. Sir, remember they activate one pathway known as MAP kinase pathway. They activate one pathway. Through MAP kinase pathway, they cause cell division. Okay? So MAP stand for mitogen activated protease, but full form is not important for you. Okay, so that is why they are known as growth receptor. So let's see the examples. Okay, so we will see the examples on the type of enzyme which is present. Okay, so what enzyme is present? Remember, the most common enzyme which is present on these receptor is tyrosine kinase enzyme. So most commonly which enzyme is present? Tyrosine kinase enzyme. And the drug which act on this tyrosine kinase type of enzyme linked receptor, that molecule or the drug is insulin. That molecule or drug is insulin. So can we say insulin causes cell division? So insulin is an anabolic hormone. insulin is anabolic hormone. So you can write other examples as well. You can write other examples as well, like epidermal growth factor. Okay, nerve growth factor. You can write toll-like receptors. But what is expected from you? You should not forget this word insulin. Okay, insulin. Now, what are the other enzymes which can be present? Which can be present? You can write serine and threonine kinase. Okay, this enzyme can also be present. The example of such drug you will write is TGF. TGF stands for transforming growth factor. Transforming growth factor. Okay. Okay. Now there is one modification. There is one modification in this ligand gated ion channel. Okay. So that modification we will write is, there is one modification. That modification is known as, that type of receptor is known as JAK-STAT receptors. So JAK-STAT receptors are the modified form of enzyme linked receptor. Let's see what is the modification. Okay, suppose this is a cell membrane and this is the receptor portion. This is the receptor portion. Okay, now remember, in this JAK-STAT receptor, there is no enzyme which is linked to the tail of this receptor. There is no enzyme. That enzyme is floating in the cytoplasm. In JAK-STAT receptor, the enzyme is not linked, the enzyme is floating. We call this enzyme is tyrosine kinase enzyme. Here the tyrosine kinase enzyme is floating in the cytoplasm. It is not linked to the receptor. Here we have seen that it is linked to a receptor. So in cases of JAK-STAT, remember this enzyme is floating in the cytoplasm. We call this enzyme as Janus kinase enzyme. We call this enzyme as a Janus kinase enzyme. So it's a type of tyrosine kinase enzyme which is floating inside the cytoplasm. Okay. Now let's see how they will function. Here in this case, we have discussed that here we need two ligands. In JAK-STAT receptor, sir, we need only one ligand. And when this ligand will come, this ligand will lead to fusion of these two receptors. It will lead to fusion of these two receptors. So this ligand will itself lead to fusion of these two receptors. Now when this receptors become fused, this signal comes to this enzyme. There will be signal transduction. There will be signal transduction, and this enzymes will become activated. This enzyme will become activated. Now this enzyme will go to the nucleus, and this enzyme will go to the nucleus, and inside the nucleus it will act on genes, and it will lead to activation of transcription. It will lead to activation of transcription. And when these genes will become activated, they will start forming various proteins. They will start forming various proteins. And these proteins will cause cell division. These proteins will cause cell division. Okay, so this pathway is known as JAK-STAT pathway. JAK stand for Janus kinase. JAK stand for Janus kinase. STAT stand for signal transduction. ST word stand for signal transduction. AT stand for activation of transcription, activation of transcription. So this is the full form of JAK-STAT pathway. So let's see what are the examples of JAK-STAT receptors we know. Okay, so the first you will write is growth hormone. Okay, remember growth hormone, it leads to formation of one protein. That protein is known as IGF protein. IGF is insulin like growth factor, which is also known as somatomedins. And these somatomedins produces anabolic effect of growth hormone. Okay, second you can write is prolactin. Prolactin leads to milk production, the proteins which are present in milk. Okay, third you can write various, you can write erythropoietin. Remember, erythropoietin leads to which cell division? Which cell division? It increases RBC number. Okay, similarly thrombopoietin. They increase platelet production. Okay, similarly you will write colony, stimulating factor. Remember, they increase WBC production. Okay, so erythropoietin produces RBC, thrombopoietin produces platelet, colony stimulating factor produces WBC. And the third point you will write is interleukin, cytokines or interferons. Okay, these receptors, they increase WBC count or WBC recruitment. Okay, especially lymphocytes. So these JAK-STAT receptors are sometimes also known as cytokine receptors, because most of the cytokines, they act on them. Okay, so these are the examples of JAK-STAT receptors. Okay, now the last type of receptors, before coming to that, a very important point. Okay, you'll write a very important point, that any mutation, suppose there is some mutation in these growth receptors. Okay, there is some mutation in this growth receptor, because of this reason there is increase in gain of function. This type of mutation is known as gain of function mutation. Now the point is, any mutation in these growth receptor due to which they are functioning continuously, remember, it will lead to cancers, or you will write uncontrolled cell division. Uncontrolled cell division. Let's take an example. So there is a receptor, growth receptor, which is present on our cell. That receptor, it has two part, which is linked to an enzyme, tyrosine kinase enzyme. Tyrosine kinase enzyme. So this receptor part, we call one of the receptor part as BCR, and the second part is as ABL. Okay, this receptor part is known as BCR and ABL. Okay, now remember, this BCR is formed by a chromosome, 9th chromosome. Okay, this ABL is formed by a chromosome, let's say 22 chromosome. Okay, now what happens, 9th and 22 chromosome, it is forming BCR, it is forming ABL, different proteins. Due to some genetic mutation, suppose these are chromosome, due to some genetic mutation, this 22nd chromosome, it translocates and attached to this 9th chromosome. Let's say there is 9, 22 translocation. That means this 22nd chromosome, it went to the 9th chromosome and it has attached. Okay, this big chromosome is known as, this now big chromosome is known as Philadelphia chromosome. Philadelphia chromosome. Okay, now what will happen? Can we say that this big chromosome will already form a fusion protein which contains BCR and ABL? It will already form one fused protein. Now suppose this fusion protein goes and bind to the cell surface. Can we say this is BCR and ABL? Okay. Can we say now in this case there is already fusion protein? And if there is fusion protein, can you tell me this protein, does it need any help of ligand to function? Does it need any help of ligand to function? Because ligand, it normally causes fusion of protein, and in this case already a fusion protein is formed. Can we say without the help of this ligand, this fusion protein will continuously function? It will continuously function. We call it as gain in function mutation. Gain in function mutation has occurred. And can we say it will continuously function? It will lead to cancers. It will lead to cancer. Okay. And the cancer of classical cancer, which is caused by BCR-ABL fusion, that example of that cancer is CML. CML, that is chronic myeloid leukemia. Okay. Chronic myeloid leukemia. So remember, any mutation in these receptor will lead to cancers. And one important point you must remember, sir, we have developed a class of drug. That drugs are known as protein kinase inhibitors. We have developed a class of drug known as protein kinase inhibitors. And these drugs, they end with the word NIB. So these drugs, they inhibit this protein kinase receptor. Can you tell me that these drugs are used in which condition? These protein kinase inhibitor, they are used as an anti-cancer drug. They are used as an anti-cancer drug. Example, the first protein kinase inhibitor drug which we have made was imatinib. It was the first protein kinase inhibitor which we have made, and this is a drug of choice. Imatinib is a drug of choice for CML. It was the first protein kinase inhibitor we have made, which will inhibit these protein kinase receptor or enzyme linked receptor. All these drugs, they end with the word NIB or IB, generally NIB word, and they are used as an anti-cancer drug. They are used in CML. Okay. So remember that we will discuss in anti-cancer drugs. Okay. So remember about these receptors. So any mutation, increase in function will lead to cancers. It will lead to cancers. So classical example is already fused dimerized protein BCR-ABL, which leads to cancer CML. Hence we inhibit this receptor. These drugs are known as protein kinase inhibitors. Okay. The drug is imatinib. It is a drug of choice for CML. Okay. Now the last receptor we have is intracellular receptor. Intracellular receptors. Okay. Now remember, intracellular receptor, they were earlier known as nuclear receptors. They are earlier known as nuclear receptors. But remember, now the better term is intracellular. Why? Because they are present inside the cell. They are present inside the cell. Earlier we used to believe that they were present only inside the nucleus. Inside the nucleus, we used to believe that they were present only inside the nucleus. But now we have come to know that they are also present in cytoplasm as well. They are also present in cytoplasm as well. Hence the better term is intracellular. But we continue to use this term nuclear receptor. But the better term is intracellular. So remember, intracellular receptors, they are of two types. Either they are intracytoplasmic or intranuclear. Okay. They are intracytoplasmic or intranuclear receptors. So some are present in cytoplasm. Let's say they are present in cytoplasm. Okay. So they are present in cytoplasm like this. Okay. Or they are present in nucleus. On nucleus, where they are present? Sir, suppose this is a gene. Okay. So they are present on the genes. They are present on the genes. Okay. They are present on the gene. You can write RXR. Okay. What is RXR? We will come to know. Though they are present on gene. Okay. So first we will write the examples and then we will see how they will function. So you will write intracytoplasmic, sir, all steroidal hormones which are produced in our body, they act through intracytoplasmic receptor. Okay, all steroidal hormones like mineralocorticoid, like aldosterone. Remember, all steroidal hormone, they are lipid soluble drug. And remember, a lipid soluble drug can cross cell membrane. A lipid soluble drug can cross cell membrane, and all steroidal drug, they are lipid soluble, hence they act through intracellular receptors. It's very logical. Then you can write glucocorticoid. Like cortisol. Okay. Similarly, all sex steroids like testosterone, estrogen, progesterone. Okay. Now, remember, there is one lipid soluble or fat soluble vitamin. That is vitamin D. So remember, vitamin D3, which is the active form, or calcitriol. So remember, vitamin D3 has intracytoplasmic receptor. Now vitamin D3 is also considered as a hormone. It is now also considered as a hormone. So it is not considered as a vitamin, it is considered as a hormone. Okay. Now let's talk about intranuclear. In intranuclear, you will write thyroid hormones. Okay, T3 and T4. Remember, thyroid hormones are not lipid soluble. They are not lipid soluble. So how they can cross cell membrane? Remember, to cross cell membrane, our cell has a special transporter. And this transporter can take T3 and T4 hormone directly to the nucleus. Okay, so they are not lipid soluble, but they act through intranuclear receptor. Okay. Although they are not lipid soluble. Then you will write, here you have written vitamin D3, here you will write vitamin A. Vitamin A, it is also a fat soluble vitamin. So its receptor is known as retinoic acid receptor, RXR, etc. Many types of receptors are present. Third, you will write PPAR receptors. PPAR alpha gamma receptors. PPAR stands for peroxisomal proliferator activating receptor. Okay, so they are also intranuclear receptors. Okay, they are also intranuclear receptors. So various drugs we have which act on these PPAR receptor, we will discuss in diabetes. Okay, which act on PPAR alpha gamma, etc. So these are the examples. Now let's see what is this structure and how do they function. Okay, now if we talk about intracytoplasmic receptors, so these intracytoplasmic receptors, they are homodimers. They are homodimers. Okay. Okay. And how do they function? So these intracytoplasmic receptor, from this cytoplasm, when a ligand comes and bind to these receptor, they go into the nucleus and they also bind to the same region where intranuclear they get bind, where the nuclear receptors are present. Okay, so you will write, they translocate to the nucleus. They translocate to nucleus. Okay, and they will bind to coactivator. Coactivator region or corepressor region. Corepressor regions on gene. They act on coactivator region or corepressor regions on the gene. Now what do we mean by this word? Let's understand. So write coactivator or co-repressor regions on gene. So suppose this is a gene, okay, and suppose this is the active form of gene which is forming a protein with a particular speed. Now what do we mean by co-activator and co-repressor region? Remember, on our gene, apart from this main active region, apart from this, there are many sites on genes which are located outside. Let's call them as co-activator or co-repressor. Sir, if this co-repressor site is activated or co-activator site is activated, what happens? If we stimulate co-activator site, it increases the speed of protein formation or genetic transcription. And when co-repressor site is activated, it decreases the speed of genetic transcription and protein formation. Okay? So these sites, they are not located on active portion of the gene, they are located elsewhere. They can increase or decrease the speed of protein formation through genes. Okay? Hence, these genes, these areas are also known as hormone responsive elements on gene. They are also known as hormone responsive elements. Okay, so these HRE, hormone responsive elements, they are present on genes which can modify the speed of gene action. So hence, what will be the action effect? They will affect protein synthesis. Either the protein synthesis will increase or the protein synthesis will decrease. Okay, now what is the structure of nuclear receptor? So these nuclear receptor, they are heterodimers. Okay, that means these proteins, you'll write that these proteins, this receptor portion, it is not a dimer form. It was not a dimer form. It is rather attached to a protein known as RXR. RXR is retinoic acid receptor. So they are heterodimers which are attached to RXR. Okay. Now, where they are present? How do they function? Remember, they are already intracytoplasmic. They have to go inside the nucleus. Intranuclear receptor, they are already located on. They are already located on hormone responsive region, responsive elements on gene. That means these receptors, they are already present on co-activator site or co-repressor site. They are already present. Okay, so what we need, we just need a ligand from outside. This ligand will directly activate a co-activator or co-repressor genes, and they will also either increase or decrease the protein synthesis. So what is the difference between intracytoplasmic and intranuclear is their location. Intracytoplasmic, they are present in cytoplasm, they translocate to the nucleus, while they are already present on the nucleus. Okay, so a very important question comes here. If somebody asks a question that which of the following drugs produce action through nuclear receptors. Remember, all of these receptors or the drugs, they produce action through nuclear receptor. Okay, so you will write why they will all produce, whether it is intracytoplasmic or intranuclear, they produce action through nuclear receptors. Because intranuclear, they are already present on nucleus. Intracytoplasmic, they translocate to the nucleus. So their action which they are producing is same. But what is the difference? The difference lies in location. Okay, location is different. Remember, intracytoplasmic, they are present in cytoplasm. Intranuclear, they are present in nucleus. Okay, but if we talk about action, their action is produced all through न्यूक्लियर रिसेप्टर्स. ओके, सो एक्शन और इफेक्ट इज ऑल ड्यू टू न्यूक्लियर रिसेप्टर. व्हाट इज द डिफरेंस? द डिफरेंस लाइज इन लोकेशन. ओके, बिकॉज इंट्रासाइटोप्लाज्मिक दे ऑल्सो गो एंड बाइंड टू द न्यूक्लियस. एंड द लास्ट पॉइंट इज अमंग ऑल फोर रिसेप्टर्स दे आर द स्लोएस्ट एक्टिंग रिसेप्टर्स. They are the slowest acting receptors. I told you fastest acting was inotropic receptor, the first one. This fourth one, intracellular, are the slowest acting. Why? Because first point, a gene will form protein. But remember, a gene first will not form protein. First, the gene will form protein, form mRNA. Then this mRNA from transcription, it will form mRNA. Through translation of mRNA, protein is formed. It will take time, and this protein, it undergoes modification, post-translational modification. And after that, when this protein is modified, this protein will produce effect. So can we say their effect is slowest? They are the slowest acting receptor, because all of this whole process will take lot of time. Okay, they are the slowest acting receptor among four. So before ending this part, let's make a summary of these receptors. So let's make a summary of all four types of receptors. Okay, so we discussed four types of receptors. First was ligand gated ion channel. Okay, which was also known as inotropic receptor. Then we discussed about GPCR, G protein coupled receptor, those were also known as metabotrophic. Then we discussed about enzyme linked receptors. Okay, or protein kinase receptor or growth receptors. And lastly, we discussed about intracellular receptors. Intracellular receptors. Okay. So let's make a summary. If you remember the shape, they were present on cell membrane, a rose-like flower. So the first three, they are present on cell membrane. The first three, they are present on cell membrane. It is present inside the cell. The fourth one is present inside the cell. Okay. So if you remember the shape was a flower pentameric rosette. Their shape was just like a snake, serpentine helical, attached to a G protein. Okay, so it was 7 transmembrane protein. Okay, they don't have any particular shape. They are enzyme linked receptor. Most common enzyme was tyrosine kinase. So let's write the first three receptors. They were present on cell membrane. They are present on cell membrane, these yellow one. Intracellular, inside the cell. Second point you will write, how do they produce their effect? They open ion channel. Because of this reason, they are the fastest acting. Okay, GPCR, how do they produce effect? They were producing enzyme, they were activating enzymes like adenyl cyclase, guanyl cyclase, etc. Okay, now they are also producing activation of enzyme. These enzymes were known as protein kinase enzymes. And how they are producing effect? They were increasing or decreasing genetic transcription so that protein is formed. Okay, now the third point you will write with them is, they are the fastest acting receptors. Their action is in milliseconds. They are the slowest acting receptors. Okay, with GPCR you will write. Okay, with GPCR you will write, they are the largest family of receptor. With GPCR you will write, they are the largest family of receptors. Okay, largest family of receptors. So this is all point you must remember among them. So their effect was ion channel, enzymes, which enzymes, which we have already discussed here, protein kinase enzymes specifically, here genetic transcription. Okay, so these are the four receptors we have discussed. So thank you very much.